Look at the graphics!
That time again! It's the Berkey and the Badger for Big Babble Show! It's gonna get wild! It's gonna get wacky! It might even get a little steamy! We're gonna talk about board games and the board game industry! And, you know, we might talk about anything else we want to talk about!
Yay! Hey! We're live. It's the Berkey and Badger Board Game Babble Show. Hey, how you doing, my good friend? Double trouble.
I'm doing very well, Mr. Kevin BGG Consolot.
Yes.
I didn't write that, people. I didn't write that. I don't know what it means. What does Consolot mean?
Consolot. We've been to lots of conventions, lots of cons.
Oh. It's not
con!
Shaka. It's not a Shaka Con. Shaka.
Shaka. Oh, yeah. Shaka.
My room is a mess now.
Hey, we have an exciting show today. Today, we have the incomparable, the illustrious, the wonderful, the incredible, the man, bear, pig himself, Brandon Nall from the Brawling Brothers Gaming Podcast.
That is not a picture of me. Look at that. Does that look anything like this? That is not me. I don't know where you got that, sir.
I like the resemblance. It looks good.
Yeah, that is good. I'd say it's good as well. Working dog.
Yeah, good.
That's our show mascot there, actually illustrated by the excellent artist Quan Chai Moria, who's done a lot of great work in the industry. And Man Bear Pig is, whether I like it or not, a part of our show.
Yes, and it's a very exciting. I got this wonderful little magnet from my good friends at BGGCon, and I like it a lot.
Sexy.
Yeah. So, well, anyway, we're gonna have a great show today. You can tell what's gonna happen now, right?
I can't see the relevance between a man, bear, pig, and what board games.
Well, our show doesn't have a lot of relevance, Barry. That's part of the fun is, you know, it man bear, who the hell knows? But he is holding a sheep. He is eating cubes. I mean, come on, give me a break here.
Okay, I couldn't see him. It's very digitized, the picture that I saw from Kevin's hand.
Well, we're going to work that out. Actually, what I'm going to do, we're going to send someone to your office there, and that entire green wall behind you, we're going to paint a mural of man bear pig.
No,
it needs a fat head. Do a fat head.
Yeah, that's it. That's how, and then you'll be able to see it.
Okay.
I don't know what it is with these pigs and bear creatures, but our good friends Rob and Patrick from Blue Peg Pink Peg, they've got the piranha pig. Look at that.
It's sassy.
I think that they were copying us. Seriously, I need to talk to Rob about that. This something's wrong.
Yeah, copyright issues.
Yeah, let's get an attorney on that.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, Brandon, if you do paint a big picture behind me, maybe you could put like a big hole in the wall where his mouth is, and any really bad games that I have, I can just like put them in his mouth.
Do you have those really bad, that bad?
No, I don't actually. I don't.
Okay.
I don't deliberately go out and buy bad games. I buy
good. We try not to. I mean, that's why we do what we do, right? So that you guys don't buy bad games.
Yeah.
Exactly. Well, tell us a little bit about yourself, Brandon. Tell us about the podcast and where you're from, and then we'll get into our segment about things that make us all go, hmm.
Yeah. Well, we'll give you 2 minutes, and then the gong will go, and then that's it.
Right? You're just going to cut me off at 2? That's
mic mute. Is that Mike how this mute. Works? We don't do mic drops here. We just do mic mutes.
There you go. There's your 2 minutes. Your 2 minutes are up.
Yes. Excellent. No, thank I mean, I'm in New Mexico. It is 8 a.m. here. Berkey's bouncing off the damn walls. I don't even know what day it is at this point. So 4 cups of coffee for Barry there. Albuquerque, New Mexico. Well. And probably 12 for Berkey by his demeanor right now. We're from Albuquerque, New Mexico. Me and my podcast partner, Josh, both live here. We've had a show for almost 2 years now. And our show's a little different. We kind of have the morning show feel to our show. We are the experts on absolutely nothing, and we're happy to tell you about it. Josh likes stuff that's very different than I like, so it adds kind of a combative element to our show, which makes us a little different. So that's fun. And the big thing is we know how to have a good time, and that's really what we try to do with our show.
So did you move out of Old Mexico to go into New Mexico?
Oh, wow. Are these jokes going to be coming all day, or is this something you run out of? Wait, this is new. Why would I have started in Old Mexico? We are in New Mexico. It seems superior, right? You want to be in the newer place?
Yes, it does. It's like old New York, whatever it is.
Old New York. Is that a thing?
No, it's old New York. No, I don't remember. I'll have to look at or I'll have to look at the jokes on my toilet roll dispenser, which I have like my toilet just around the corner there. So.
How was that? Was that my 2 minutes?
You had time, but now it's gone.
Well, it's Barry's fault. He's eating up my mic time here.
It's better than eating toilet paper.
It is.
No, I got to say, about a year ago, I started listening to the Brawling Brothers, and just really, it's a very entertaining podcast about board games and all kinds of crazy stuff. I mean, you guys go off the rails like we do a lot, and so I find that very entertaining. And I like the fact that your format, you know, you guys take your time with it. It's not a 30-minute show. You guys, if you got a long commute and you want to listen to it, I'll listen to it usually over a couple days even sometimes. But I love you guys. You guys are a lot of fun.
Does a long commute include traveling all the way from Minnesota to Texas?
Yes, of course it does.
So a 6-hour plane journey will suffice for one episode of.
Yeah, plus
a long commute for me is just mowing my lawn. Okay.
If we ever get to 6 hours, I quit. We're not doing that. 6 hours is a little too much. I'm sorry, Berkey. I know that you're really batting here for the longer episodes, but people can only stand so much of our idiocy.
Well, it's a lot of fun. We got to actually meet Josh, your compadre, at BGG Con, and I just got to say, I love this guy. If I was in New Mexico, I'd be hanging with him. I don't know about you, but I'd be hanging with him.
No, you know, I joke all the time that I really only like him 2 days of the month. That's the second and fourth Tuesday of every month, which is when our episode drops. I'm happy that he's my buddy on that day. And then every other day of the month, I mean, I have to work with him to make this awesome content. So I'm done with him. So 2 days a month is all I like him.
Well, he's a man after my own heart. He likes, he's a carnivore. He likes meat, and he has sausage fingers like I do. And
yeah, funny story there, actually. We're doing the Secret Santa within our guild on BGG, and Josh's Santa is excellent. He's completely mocked Josh for weeks now, and yesterday we both received a gift from our Secret Santa, and I got a copy of Vinos Deluxe, the top-end one. It was an amazing gift. Josh got a book entitled 30 Ways to Become a Vegan. I thought it was amazing. I mean, it was so outstanding. So we took a picture last night. Josh is holding 30 Ways to Become a Vegan, and I'm holding Vinos Deluxe, and he looks a little dejected. I don't, like, his spirits are a little down, but I, you know, it shows you our listeners and the humor that they have.
Okay. Yes, but that's not humor. That's torture. That's brutality.
Well, wasn't that book turned into a film with Kim Basinger and Nick Nolte? edit that one out. Or add a future Barry in there. Yeah. It's your move on.
Before we get right into our spot about things that make you go oom, we're going to just talk a little bit about things that you've been up to, Barry, and then we're going to do a little bit of a BGG Con recap with Brandon and I real quick. But Barry, what you been up to?
Our episode, this is. With the BGG highlights. Yeah, I think it's, okay. Little secret, I am currently working on some music. Big news.
Cool.
Way cool. For a board game. But that's all I can say.
Ta-da.
I like this.
Yes, I've been asked to do some music.
You might not have heard this before, Brandon, but Barry has this awesome CD called Last Night, and it's kind of a darkish, a zombie-feeling soundtrack, and it's fantastic for those type of games. And Barry's quite a musician, so he's got a lot of skills. He's got nunchuck skills, computer hacking skills, bow craft skills. Yeah.
Wow. Amazing.
With just one finger.
That's, you know, so it's funny that you bring that up. That's something we talk about on the show really regularly, is we always play music while we're playing games and how much that can actually add to an experience. That I think it's wonderful. So hats off to you, sir. I'll be looking out for your project announcement. I actually feel like I almost should like prod you here a little bit and like try to pull a little more info from you. But I know that we don't like have a high level of trust yet. So next time you do this to me, we're going to be in a better place and I'll peel a little something out of you.
I'm ready to divert this whole podcast just to talk about music. What do you use and with which game? And I think that's going to be a future episode.
That should be an episode. I will. There's a service I'll plug real quick. It's called, we talked about it on our last episode. It's called Mellodice. It's mellodice.org. And it's just a real simple little computer script that allows users to submit YouTube playlists for a specific game. So if you hop on there and you look up Caverna, you're going to get a bunch of a list of music that people have submitted that applies to Caverna. So really a cool deal, and we've been using the heck out of it.
Cool. Oh, cool. Well, Barry, also, you have a Patreon and for your YouTube channel, Board Games Everybody Should. And I know people that join your Patreon. This is unsolicited plug for you, obviously, but
I thought so.
You can actually win a copy of this last night CD. So join Barry. You don't have to do much. Just give him a little bit of money.
Yeah. I do a raffle every month with my Patreon. So if you donate $5 or more, what will happen is your name will go in a hat, and the more people that donate, the more names I'll draw out this hat to win a free copy or digital copy of Last Night.
Ooh. Cool. No, it's really a lot of fun.
So yeah, I'm doing some music for a board game. I can't tell you anything else apart from that. So hopefully in a couple of months, I'll be able to open up and say, it's this game, and you'll wet your pants.
So is this a game that's going to be on Kickstarter, or is this
No, it's coming out next year. That's it.
Next year? What time next year? First quarter?
Moving right along. Do, 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 do. I'm not giving you any clues.
I need to do my Baba Wawa. You know, wow, bad way, bad way, bad way. I'm not interviewing you well.
No.
I need to get some information. Come on. Help the give the people what they want, you know?
See, you trust Kevin. You don't trust me. That's the thing here. I mean, maybe he can pull something out of you.
No, he can't pull anything out of me.
I don't want to pull anything out of him. Trust me. You don't want to know what's in.
I thought you were the sound guy. Shouldn't there be a drum kick here? I don't know.
Okay,
I mean,
okay, drum kick. Yeah. One.
That's
the one. Oh, there
we go. It's always right. Delayed.
Yeah.
Third time's a charm.
Yeah.
See what you started?
I'm sorry. Hey, we do the same thing in our show, so, you know, I got to keep Josh on his toes.
So tell us a little bit, Brandon, about your experiences at BGGCon. I haven't heard much on your podcast referring to BGG yet. But.
Yeah, our BGG recap episode actually comes out on Tuesday. So we recorded the whole thing last night, start to finish. It was exhausting. But the time was amazing. It's one of the best cons that we've ever been to. It's always one of our favorites because, I don't know, it's that con's a little more intimate than a lot of the others. I game nonstop there. I don't tend to work as much, which I really like. But man, we played so many great games. I'll tell you that probably one of the biggest highlights of the con for us, and the people who've played it will all agree, Captain Sonar with 8 players is really, really something special, especially in that type of environment where everyone's energized and into it. Captain Sonar from Asmodee is really, really good.
Is it less chaotic than like Space Cadets Dice Duel or?
No, not at all. No, it's more
very, very similar.
Yeah, it's very stressful, but it's, you know, it's really exciting because of the level of communication that's required between both sides of the table. You know, everyone has to be paying attention, and sometimes in a con setting, it's a little loud, so that makes it a little challenging. But we would always go to, you know, a room off of the main gaming hall or something like that. Anyone who hasn't played Captain Sonar, there's two competing subs that are cruising through this ocean space trying to blow each other up. And you have access to things like sonar and drones, and you can go silent and try to slip away. You can actually surface and fix your systems. And each player, four per side, plays a different role on this sub. And they all kind of work together in coordination. It's
I heard the radar person is really an important component.
Yeah, yes, absolutely. I always got stuck with like the guy that, you know, couldn't even walk, didn't know his name. He's my radar guy. Who chose these teams? I think Josh actually did it on purpose, right? He like gave me the incompetence. So yeah, I don't know. It was a setup from start to finish. A setup.
Oh, you need some radar love.
That's right.
He gave you the incompetence. That's how it works.
Yes, yes.
I thought you were just born with incompetence.
Hey, what? Whose side are you on here? Come on.
Well, I was referring to myself, of course.
Oh,
I
would, all right.
I would never self-deprecate you.
Let's see what else. The rest. I'm just going on. I'm not even touching it, Kevin. I'm just going on it. The amount of people that we got to see, industry people in particular, is outstanding. Josh has a big, important corporate job, and he doesn't get to travel a lot. I, like you, make most of the cons, but it was really cool for us to be in the same place at the same time and see a lot of our friends, a lot of the content creators that we interact with daily. You know, it's really neat to be face-to-face with someone when you just send a couple of tweets every few days or something like that. So that FaceTime is really exciting. A couple of other highlights for me is Texas barbecue, man.
Texas, oh yeah, baby.
Barbecue is about as good as it gets. I actually got to share an excellent meal with you, Berkey, and the Arcane Wonders guys at Hard Eight. If you get to Dallas, Texas, go to Hard Eight and gorge yourself on delicious, delicious animal flesh. It was so good.
2-inch thick pork chop, baby.
Yeah, it was impressive, wasn't it?
That was very impressive. It was like Fred Flintstone, you know, when you drive up and you get the whole rack.
Right.
Just like that.
That was a highlight. Another highlight that a lot of people don't know about is the BGG guys have an Artemis setup. Do you guys know what Artemis is?
Yeah, I've seen that.
Okay, so for anyone that doesn't, Artemis is a computer game. It's a bridge simulator, like imagine Star Trek or something like that. And you can play with up to, I think it's six people. And you sign up for a time slot and you show up and your six people run this starship for 30 minutes or an hour. And our group, we play for almost 2 hours throughout. And it's awesome. There's a captain, which I, of course, was a captain. I mean, it only made sense. Especially since I was so inept at Captain Sonar, right? I mean,
of course, you are the captain. Yeah. Who else would you be?
That's it. So there's a weapon.
You knew your name and you were able to walk, so that made a good captain.
That did well, and you know, I did the captain thing. I pushed in my chair, and I didn't even sit at the helm. I just, you know, I walked back and forth, pacing, looking at everyone else's screens. Which, so there's a weapons guy. There is a. Engineering, there's a communications guy, there is the actual the driver. What the hell would the driver be called?
Navigator,
whatever, helmsman, whatever he is.
Helmsman.
Sulu. And just like Captain Sonar, everyone's working together in concert, and it's a really cool experience. So every year, that is that's something that our group looks forward to. I'm from the video game industry. I cut my teeth there. So it's neat to go. It's neat to kind of relive that side of my life at these conventions.
Oh, yeah. They're very nice.
You like that?
He's in concert. I thought he was playing games, but now he's in a concert cutting his teeth.
Yeah.
I don't understand.
Do you do that on the discs?
Yeah. It's like Klingons. They sharpen them before battle. That's what it is.
Yeah, I don't need any.
You're too young to remember cassette games, aren't you?
Oh, seriously? We're not going to talk about age here. I look decent for my age. We'll go with that, okay?
Okay.
Well, it's because you wax.
That's right.
Okay. Yeah, likewise, I had a blast at BGG Con. This is one of my favorite cons. What I like about BGG Con is it has this much more relaxed feel, and it's the end of the con season. You know, you're gearing up. You start these cons in the spring, and then all of a sudden Origins hits, and it's ramping up to the big, you know, climax of Gen Con and all the craziness that is Gen Con. And then all of a sudden things start to mellow out a little bit, and that's BGG Con. It's a place where you can just go and play games. You can meet people, get this opportunities to hang out with folks. And I always, there's several friends I get to, I always hook up with Sean and Alex from Dukes of Dice and Sean's wife Raquel. And we actually got to play a game we've been waiting to play for a long time. And it's one of Sean's favorite games. He's from your neck of the woods, right?
Yes, he lives here in Albuquerque. It's crazy, but there's, you know, two reasonably well-known podcasts in this little town.
Yeah, right. And we got to play Zulkin from Czech Games. And this is one of Sean's favorite games and top 10. I think it's his second or third top game. And it was late at night, and this is a little bit thick game, so it took me a little while. It wasn't until around the third or fourth round that it started making sense, and I never had enough corn. So you need a lot of corn in this game.
I thought you were carnival.
Yeah, that's the problem. There wasn't enough meat in it, and I would have done
the problem is you didn't cut your teeth enough. That's the problem. Like, you needed the corn, you know, it's fine. Sorry.
Yeah, I know exactly. Well, that was the scoop. So that was a good time. Got to play. One of the big highlights, I'm going to show you a picture here. I don't know if off on my picture here. So, oh, that's
cut that one off. Cut it off. Cut it off now.
That is not the one. There's a new game. As many of you know, Arcane Wonders has sponsored our show. We're very grateful for that. We're going to be sharing some more information with you about that. But Arcane Wonders has a brand new game coming out in April. It's gone to print already, but you'll see it on my back shelf right up here. It's called Spoils of War. And this is a liar's dice mechanism in the game. But you have artifacts that give you special abilities, and you're collecting sets of weapons and jewels. You're these Viking chieftains, and rather than blow, you know, you got all this loot that you got to split up. Rather than fighting over it, they've decided to play a game of chance, and this game is Spoils of War. Super lot of fun, but I'm actually helping them out again as a character, like I did with Royals as the king. And here's a picture of the Viking chieftain that I am portraying.
Ah, that's more than just the belly of last time.
Yes.
Are you the hardest working person in board gaming there, Berkey? I mean, your hands are in everything.
Well, mostly just sausage, but
yeah.
Well, it was an awful lot of fun. And I think Paul Grogan is the hardest working guy in board gaming. I think anybody that creates media is the hardest working person in board gaming, right?
It's not an easy job. If anyone is listening and you think it's a good idea to start a podcast, don't.
Especially a 3-hour one like you guys do.
Bad idea. Just trust me. And if you love your life. One. Yep. Not good. Yeah. I don't know how this is. Yeah. Not good.
Yeah, no, I tell you, I've just had so much fun working with Arcane Wonders. I really love these guys. And the games that they've produced, I've just had so much fun with. You know, before we even started our board game theater, we fell in love with Sheriff of Nottingham, and that became the first character. But one of the highlights for me was about 3 years ago, I was the Sheriff of Nottingham at BGGCon. And just the fact to be able to interact with fans and friends and that kind of stuff, and then as a character playing these games, it just added this extra element of fun. And we got that same opportunity at BGG here with Spoils of War because they were just introducing it. So we played with tons of different groups. When we went to Heart 8, we got to play with Josh and Brandon, as well as the designer, Brian Pope, the president of Arcane Wonders, and the co-designer, Jason, of the game as well. Excuse me. And we just had a blast. I had a horrible game.
You were miserable. Actually, you did something that apparently has never happened before, and you were just flat broke.
Yeah, and I way overbid on a, I thought, a sure bet, and I ended up running out of it. And now there's some they've actually, because of Berkey, because of this great playtesting, now there's a rule that you cannot run out of money.
Yeah, I couldn't believe it. And it was clear that Brian couldn't believe it either. He was scratching his head. He kept looking under the table, like wondering if you had dropped some of your money or, I mean, it was, they'd never seen it clearly. So good job breaking this game. But the important thing is that it facilitated a rules change that'll make the game better in the long run. So hats off to you, sir.
Yeah, what did you think about spoils?
It was a blast. We had a great time. You know, we actually talked about it on our show last night. It was exciting, and it's the type of game that our group is totally into. There's, you know, hooting and hollering, and there's bluffing, and that's so much fun to us because, I mean, I guess that we're a bunch of liars. I'm not really sure, but I, you know, don't judge us on that. But I think in the big picture, that's what's exciting to us. So these types of games are great for our group. There's a little bit for everyone here, and it's simple enough that anyone can sit down and play. But on the other hand, there is a little bit of meat there. And once you've played multiple times, there's going to be refinement of strategy. But in the big picture, you're rolling dice, man. Lady Luck in you, that's it. You better be good to her or you're going to be broke like Berkey was. Sorry, Berkey. It was really bad. So embarrassing for him.
That was a very unique situation. But nonetheless, what a great game.
When Arcane Wonders start producing other games, like maybe a zombie game, are you going to be a zombie?
Well, you know, this is funny. Old Tom Vassell, the towering man that he is, stops by the Arcane Wonders booth, and I'm in my Vikings costume, and he runs over to Tony Galati, the sales manager, and he says, "So are all of your games going to have this old guy with a white beard?"
Oops. Yeah, and I'm just wondering if they pick up the rights to do Rococo, you're going to love wearing that dress, I think.
Well, thank you.
Yes, I'm actually going to push for that. I'm going to send an email right now on that. That sounds like a great idea.
Well, I'll be the male seamstress, okay?
Yeah, okay.
I'm not going to wear the dress, okay? Just saying. But anyway, Tom, he says this whole deal, and I looked at Tom, and I gave him that look, you know, with you get the bull eyes, you know? I said to him, I said, "Now listen, Tom, you like my Burt's Happy Mouse signature spice, right?" Because I always fix him, you know, I hook him up, you know? And he looked at me, and I said, "You better stop right now, or else I'm cutting you off."
The supply will be diminished.
I said, and I said, "I'm not ashamed. I can die too."
Like die?
No, or? not like die dead.
Oh, but this like, got it got so morbid for a second there.
No, die like it, like waxing. You know, you wax. I'm not gonna wax. Okay, you do the waxing. You got that clean bare chest. I'm sure you do. So I'm not.
I have no clue what you're talking about.
Well, I don't either, but. But if this beard turned white, well, or turned black, it could turn black. I'd look 30 years younger. I'm only 23, so I don't know. Anyway, BGGCon, what a blast. I got to say one little quick more story about BGGCon is I got to participate in one of my favorite two-player games, and that is – stop it, Barry. I'm going to mute you. One of my favorite two-player games. Ah, Brandon's got a picture of Berkey with his costume on.
Look at how good Berkey was looking. I mean, look at that guy. If I've ever seen a Viking, it's this man right here.
For impressive glory! Stuff.
Impressive Valhalla. Stuff.
Well, you're very impressive yourself there, young man.
Yeah, a bit of a beefcake by the look of it.
I don't know about any of that.
I wouldn't want to brawl with you.
No, not with the beefcake. We got a new nickname for him. He's the beefcake.
Oh, God. I hope this doesn't stick. That's not going to go over well.
Okay, so one of my favorite two-player games, Baseball Highlights 2045. And we got to actually play a tournament. And we had four of us in the main tournament, Mike Fitzgerald, the designer, along with one of the co-producers, Ralph Anderson, who's a brilliant baseball highlights player. He was one of the co-developers with Eagle Griffin. And likewise, we played a nine-game tournament. Alex Goldsmith from the Dukes of Dice was in it. Dan King, the Game Boy Geek, was in it. There's another fellow, and I keep forgetting his name. Was in on it, and you basically play this round-robin tournament. You're drafting your cards, and you keep this deck for the entire tournament. Well, when it was long and short of it, I ended up going to the finals against Dan King and in our group. Ralph and Mike Fitzgerald had a 9-game tournament amongst themselves because we only had 6 total people in the tournament. So, and the winner of that was going to play the champion of the 4-game tournament. So I play Dan King, the Board Game Geek, and I ended up beating Dan. And what was cool about it was this. I had a combination. I had the card, for those of you that know the game, I had the Animator. And the Animator, what he does is he gives you an extra single for every card that you're going to play thereafter if you are behind in the game. So all you got to do is let them score first, and then you're going to get an extra single every time. Well, I also had comboed out with a closer and 1 Magna Glove in my deck. Magna Glove cancels 2 hits. Anyway, long and short of that, Dan has this card with his robot that gives him a leadoff home run. And he thinks he's got this game won, man. He thinks, I've won. I beat Berkey. I'm going to be the champion. And then the Animator comes onto the playing field. Yes, and he animates it. So, and Dan King, all he just went, oh, shit. It was great fun. So I ended up defeating Dan King in a close match. He's a very good player. And then went to the finals against Ralph Anderson, who beat Mike Fitzgerald, the designer. Ralph is readily known as one of the best players. I really, really have a great time with Ralph, but I had never played him in baseball highlights. We played a 5-game World Series, and I beat him 3-1 with my Animator. And a very similar thing happened with him, but he's a brilliant player, and I am the champion of Baseball Highlights 2045. Thank you very much.
I feel honored to actually be in this space. I'm sitting here with one of the best, very smug, very, you know, I mean, very good looking, large bearded baseball highlight players in the entire universe.
In the universe, yes, in the universe. No, this is seriously, these guys are brilliant players and I am not. And for me to have that
opportunity.
What?
Grandpa, you finished your story.
Barry's bored because of our conversation.
I think really the problem is he's just jealous and he's deflecting. He wasn't there. He wasn't hanging out with us. It's fine. Next year, Barry.
Next year.
We love you, Barry.
Save the pennies.
Yeah, we're going to sell them. Yeah, let's move on to our segment. Things that make you go,
makes go, Board game news. Berkey and Badger reflect on the current events that are happening in the board game industry. Some may be good, some may be bad, but there are all things that make us go,
I hate the Google Hangout, it doesn't work.
So, Barry, tell us some things that have been making you go,
excuse me.
me.
We talk for so long, he has no voice now, Kevin, so he's...
Yeah. Even my speaker switched themselves off because they were waiting to go, is it phase 2 now? So what's been making me go, I've been a bit upset. It's very rare that I read criticism about something and get a bit upset. And I read some...
Here it goes. The rant is coming from Barry.
I was going to make this show, actually, the rant. But I'm going to try and keep this as short and sweet as possible. There was an article, a blog posted from an employee who used to work for Asmodee. And they were unhappy about working on the project Conan because they found it sexist and racist. And I found this extremely, it upset me. And I found it hard to believe that someone would say that again about something. My voice is going. Where's it gone? I'm really upset there. It was so upsetting. I found it hard to believe that someone would see things that were, you know, not historical, but if you're looking at literature, especially classical literature, you can't really change it. You can't really tinker with it too much because it's classical literature. You know, imagine if someone found that Oliver Twist was actually sexist. Would we remove it from our schools as a, you know, as teaching? Excuse me. And yeah, as I said, this kind of made me go, because I mean, yes, there is naked ladies in the game, but there's one naked.
There's naked ladies in the game.
There's one naked lady.
You suddenly have Berkey's attention.
Yeah.
No.
He's waxing.
Hey.
And you know, I didn't see the argument about that. I didn't see the argument. There was an argument about the females in the game were used as the not the heroines, but as the maiden in distress. And if you think about it logically, that's what happened in those kind of eras. And also that's what kind of happens in practically almost every Disney film that you see. So why would you complain about it? And yeah, so yeah, that's the short version.
Well, okay, Brandon, now that the hornet's nest has been poked, what do you think about that?
Yeah, I mean, I'm on Barry's page. I don't think that it's a big deal. I mean, there has to be, there has to be a greater good. There has to be a cause, and it just happens that that's how the writers of the game wrote that in. I don't think that there's a problem with it. You know, my daughter is a huge Disney fan. We watch every Disney movie that comes out, and you know, Barry's right. There's always a damsel in distress. And I don't, I mean, maybe Barry's onto something. Maybe there should be a prince in distress and a strong female character rescue him. I mean, how will that go over?
Yeah, I think
like Holy Grail, Monty Python.
Yeah, I think it's interesting. You know, Barry sent me his copy of his prototype of Conan, and I opened it up, and one of the extra rule books has got a bare-breasted naked woman on an altar. I had a problem with that. I mean, if I had young children, I wouldn't want that to open up that box and have them see that.
Yeah, fair enough.
You know, I understand the writings of Conan, you know, and I think it's all thematic, but I'm also of the opinion that there are people who have stories, and this can be terrifying to some people, the way it was depicted. So if someone has a criticism, I have sympathy and I can kind of understand. At the same point, you know, it's almost like Jesse Shakey, he's just got on there and he said, I think board games really should have a rating system. And I don't know about that, but I would have maybe liked to have been warned of that. In a sense.
But then maybe books should have rating system as well then, because the amount of books that you can buy and there are foul language and there is nudity or gratuitous violence and sex, you know, but there's nothing on the book to say that it's not in there or anything to say that it is in there apart from the cover.
Yeah, you know, I think it's kind of a complex thing, and some people are going to be offended by things that other people aren't going to be offended by. I wasn't really offended by it, but there was it did give me pause when I saw it. Now I used to read.
Anyone that knows Conan is going to want to buy the game. Anyone that doesn't know Conan is probably not going to know about the game. So it's kind of its own fish to eat. You know.
Yeah, it's a big game though, so there's a lot of buzz going on about it, and Until I actually read the article once it came out from the gal that left Asmodee, Jamie Kagi from The Secret Cabal had made very nice comments about the gal that wrote it. And I read the article, and honestly, I had some problems with some of the things she was saying. Mm. I thought it was taking it a little bit too far in some of the conclusions. And yet, there are sensitivities, and you know, that's a tough line, I think. I don't know. What do you think, Brandon?
Well, I mean, so I'm actually going to skip. I'm going to skip you on the things that make me go hmm, and I'm going to jump in here with mine. And mine is, while there's much more to talk about than the nudity side of it, Mine is Kingdom Death Monster that's on Kickstarter right now, which this is a big thing with Kingdom Death Monster is there is very, very adult themes here. And, you know, I think it takes us back to the comment about rating systems. And, you know, again, I'm from the video game industry and that's become a big thing there. So is it time for us to do something like that in our industry? Is it time for us to make people more aware of the content that's in the game? There's nothing in Kingdom Death Monster that I would be good with my 9-year-old daughter seeing. That said, me and my group, we're capable of coping with that. Now, it's not for everyone, but there is some very adult stuff in that box.
Yeah, and I'm looking at it now, and it's up to $7 million, which is incredible. 14,000 backers.
Yeah, amazing. I mean, just a crazy number. So, I don't know. I mean, it's a touchy subject, but the other industries in the world, the other entertainment industries, you know, that's something that's prevalent there and we're seeing it here now. So I guess the question is, how do we deal with it? How do we make it safe for every gamer to make sure that they know what they're getting before they actually get it, before they open that box?
Mm. Good question.
Yeah, I think it's a really great point, Brandon, and a really great question. And I think it's time for us, you know, because of the proliferation and the hobby board game market becoming really, you're starting to see a lot of mainstream, you know, exposure to board games now. And so, and with likewise, even with the, you know, games becoming more prevalent in the big box stores, the hobby games, you know, Target and Barnes and Noble, things of that nature. So while these games probably we won't find there, I think it is a relevant question.
Yep. So I'm going to go on to the other side of it. And this makes me go, this is something that I was so mad at myself for missing whenever it was on Kickstarter originally. Everyone loves this game. Everyone that plays it that isn't offended by the content thinks it's something special. So now here it is. It's my chance to hop back in. And there's two things that made me go, A number one is the price point of this game. Now, for anyone that's not familiar with it, the minis in this game are unbelievable. I see at least one Cool Mini or Not guy in the chat here. Cool Mini or Not makes absolutely the most beautiful minis in board gaming. I mean, they've really set the standard for me for what I expect out of miniatures. This game, they rival that. I mean, it's gorgeous. So I understand the price associated with building those. But when we start talking about $350 for the base level pledge, and I start looking at all the goodies that I want to get, $700 for, I mean, I don't even know how, my wife would leave. I would have to come to Minnesota and dig a hole in the snow and live with Uber. $700?
Survival tips.
And that's just for the pinups that you get. Nice big posters of fantasy characters.
Yeah,
I tell you, Rob Rouse from Blue Peg Pink Peg, on their episode, they were discussing this, and his wife did not know the amount of money that he spent on the first Kingdom Death Monster. And when the total came in of $450, you could hear the air being sucked out of the podcast room when she said, "What?"
Yeah, it's something. I mean, it's crazy. And the craziest part about all of this is I'm still considering it because the production is so great and what people have said about the experience is so high, but it's a crazy amount of money.
The one thing I will say, it's not going to be released till 2020, if I remember correctly.
Okay, so that's my second point, all right? So let's tackle that a little bit. They are doing something similar to what other publishers are doing, and that is kind of the trickle effect. So that was my first turnoff. I'm like, I am not going to give you my $700 for it to sit in your bank account and make interest while I'm waiting 4 years. That's not okay. Mm-hmm, but if you actually start to dig in a little bit, you know, there are waves planned and estimated delivery on some of the waves. Wave one is actually summer of 2017. So that has turned a lot of people off. There's been a ton, an absolute ton of discussion about that. And it was my first, whoa, wait a second. But then I used my eyes and I read. I mean, I know that this is the internet. Why would we read things, right? But if you read, the details are there. But this could take a long time to fulfill. And I expect that it's going to be similar to maybe what Cool Mini or Not did with Black Plague. And that is, here's the base game. And then it's the trickle effect with everything else, which my group's talked about. That's great because that gives you a chance to explore the base game, really enjoy it. And then when you're just getting tired of it, something else shows up. So that I'm really okay with that if they follow through with this 1 or 1.5 years plan.
Okay. Yeah, that sounds better because I was worried that if it could take 4 years for just the base game to get to your door, someone else might create the same kind of experience in a much cheaper and quicker form within a year, say on a Kickstarter. And then why would you want to spend $300 when you can spend $50 on a game which is the same?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's for sure. One of the things that made me go was a recent product offering by AEG, and it's the 3-part expansion for Planes, the game Trains, and Automobiles. Of course, Trains was still, was kind of a successor, if you will, the Dominion deck building game was pretty popular. They had an expansion come out called Rising Sun. Then Automobiles came out, and then also Planes just recently came out. But what was interesting that made me go, about this deal was this is 3 expansions for all 3 games in one box, and it's $79 retail.
We seem to be very price sensitive this morning, don't we?
Yes.
I think it's Christmas time or what?
Maybe.
Yes. Stocking fillers.
Maybe just broke sensitive. So, Planes, Trains, first off, I enjoyed Trains. I had Trains. I actually traded it to my good buddy, Jesse Shakey. And
now you want it back.
Yeah, I actually do, Jesse. So, or just come over and play it with me, okay? So, no, but I haven't, I wanted to play Planes, but I haven't played it. And I didn't hear real great things about Automobiles, so I never bought it. Now I'm being forced to buy an expansion for games that I don't own if I want the expansion for Planes. I don't know. It just seemed like a really weird marketing idea. I don't know if it made me feel more negative than it did positive. So I don't know if they're going to maybe break it up and offer it in different expansions, but it gave me pause. What do you think about that?
Well, I'm thinking of actually buying about 50 odd copies and then breaking them up and selling them on my eBay individually. And then making a bit of a profit.
You're a shyster, I can tell.
No, I wouldn't do that. But that is probably what someone's going to probably do.
Yeah, I don't know.
Get my expansion. Go ahead.
I don't know. I actually haven't played any of the games. This is the one it's like Dominion with like a spatial thing and a board. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. I haven't played it yet, so I can't really speak on it. I am a huge Dominion fan. It was one of my gateway games, so I'd imagine that I would like it. But do you think that a lot of the people that own one of these own all 3 of them, and it's a value for them?
Possibly. There are people out there that collect, sets of things like the Towson games from Yellow and what was it, the Cosmos collection, yeah, and stuff like that.
Well, if it were a $49 price point, that'd be a different story because then it'd be a, $15, $16, and then it'd be a value. But at $80, I mean, most of the expansions are running $24 to $34. I don't know.
Maybe.
I don't know what the expansions, how good they are. It just made me go pause. So, well, with that, we're done with our section, things that make you go, And we're going to move right into our first impression segment, the good, the not so bad, and the ugly.
Whoa. We're running about 30 minutes behind.
Drop. No, this is becoming the new Brandon Brawling Brothers show.
Oh, right. This is called a new Brandon Brothers show. It says track 3. Yeah. No, it's track 3 is behind the door. I've skipped ahead. tractor. That says tractor as well.
Do you guys know what you're doing? What the hell is going on right now?
When have we ever known what we're doing?
That's why it's called the Babble.
This is a fly by the seat of your pants deal, okay?
You wait till you hear the mix at the end. It'll be so much neater. It'll be 10 minutes long.
It'll be pretty like your podcast. It'll be really pretty.
Hi, Brandon. Hi, Brandon. Yeah. Oh, hello. Welcome to the show. Oh, yeah. It's nice to be here. All right. Thanks. Bye.
There you go. Fixed. That'd
be the audio version. So don't even send me your WAV. All right.
Just, you got it.
I'll impersonate you. Keep talking.
All right. You going to play a drop or you going to just edit that in?
Yeah.
Play the drop. People are waiting for the drop.
There we go. It's done. Ali, let's go. We're beyond.
That was enough of that.
That was not good.
All right. The good, the bad, and the ugly section is our first impression section, where we talk about a game that we played once, and then we tell you if it's good. Well, we'll ask you if you think we think it's good, bad, or ugly. Good is a game that we will play definitely again. A bad is a not-so-bad game, which we wouldn't mind playing if it snuck underneath our nose. And an ugly game is a game that we would avoid at all costs. So, Berkey, more dearest, you've been playing. What have you been playing?
Oh, I played a game at BGGCon that I played one time, and I played it with the boys from R&R Games, Dan DiLorenzo. And it's a game called Touria.
Oh, that's not what you've written down here. You lying little monkey.
I'm messing with you, buddy old pal.
I was going to get ready to do that because you...
Yep.
Yeah.
Well, you can still do it because it's fun.
It's not Royals, though, is it?
Well, Touria, you can see this is a fantasy setting game. Take a look at that there. You can kind of see the map. Notice in the corner of the game, there are these little castles, and there are pictures on the castle. And these are your action selections that are available to you. Every time you take an action, what happens is you turn that castle, and that will give you another option on the next turn. However, other people have one of those actions facing them, and so they could take one of those actions. So basically, you have four castles, so you have four options. And then that's going to change throughout the game. Basically, what you're doing throughout the game is you're collecting gems and different things so that you can actually go into the castle and try to find the princess or find the prince. And the first person to do that, it's kind of a race type of mechanism there too, to get into the castle, to get that first choice. And you might not find them right away, and you have to go back out and collect more gems, fight the dragon, different things of that nature. So with that said, brief overview, what do you think I think about Touria from R&R Games?
Ooh, I think that you think that it's a game about towers.
That's true. It's a towering game. Yes.
Why is it whenever we do this section, I start reading all the chat comments and I totally ignore what you're talking about?
I don't know.
I'm going to tell you, not so bad.
Not so bad. So what do you think, Brandon?
Yeah, I'm actually going to go with not so bad. You didn't seem very enthusiastic when you were talking about, and you don't really look enthusiastic now. Actually, you look kind of bored. I almost wonder if I should go with the ugly, but I don't. I mean, there can only be one ugly in this chat. We're not going to say who that is, but I'm going to go with
the not pissed. So bad. The good, the bad, and the pissed.
He doesn't know me very well, does he, Ben?
Yeah, he doesn't.
No. There's very few uglies that show up on this show. But well, you both fell for the classic blunder. Inconceivable. It's good.
Oh, yes.
Hey, the Grinch loves me. Is that what that says? The Grinch loves me.
The Grinch says I love Brandon.
Wow.
Wow. His heart must have grown three sizes. It would have had to, right?
Yes.
No, yes, you fell for the classic blunder. I enjoyed this game so much that I actually purchased it. And it's got this fantasy, whimsical feel. It's quick. It plays in about an hour, so it's not hard to get to the table. I knew my daughter, Gabrielle, would just love this game. It just has got that fun feel. It's pretty easy to pick up. It's got the set collection elements and all of those kind of things, some interesting special abilities when you go to the tea hut and you're moving along this board and you can go fight the dragon. So you kind of feel immersed, but there's this excitement about going into the castle and flipping over these windows to find where the prince or the princess is. And if you don't get that first, you know, there's a pretty good chance that you're not going to, the other person's going to come in there and maybe find them. But there's that, there's a little bit of random with that. I don't know if this is first impressions. I don't know how much replayability this game is going to have for me. I'm not sure, but the set collection or your action selection, that was a really cool mechanic that I haven't quite seen work like that before. And the game really looks beautiful. It's got really nice components. So I had a blast with that. So that's why I say it's good. How about you, Barry?
Okay. My first impressions. I played a game, and it's not this one, actually. It's called Cottage Garden. I've changed my mind. I'm going to talk about Cottage Garden.
Not the only one being trickster here.
No. I think it's a bit easier to explain than not alone. Anywho, in Cottage Garden, you'll have two plots of garden. And in the middle of the table, you'll have a board. And it has these different flower arrangements, kind of like Tetris shape sizes and pieces and bobs and stuff like that. And there's this dice going around, which counts the levels of the game, rounds of the game, sorry, it's a dice. So it's six rounds of the game that you'll be playing for. And every time a dice is on a line, you can take one of the tiles, which has lovely little flowers on it, from that line and add it to your garden. And whenever you got one of your garden sections filled up, you remove it and you score for it, if I remember correctly. My brain's going soft. And you keep going around and you're
going soft.
Yes, going soft.
Gone soft. Going gone soft. Barry's gone soft.
Yeah.
Okay.
Like you said. So anyhow, you're doing some gardening, Tetris style, and you're building gardens. And at the end of the game, the player that's got the most points is the winner. Yeah. Because there's a point system. Yeah, I remember it now. It's all coming back to me. It's been a while, but it's all coming back. So yeah, Cottage Garden.
Okay, how many players is it?
Four.
It is up to four.
Yeah.
So this is the Uwe Rosenberg game that's kind of like a successor to Patchwork, correct?
Yeah.
They sold 2,800 copies of it at Essen. They sold out.
Yep.
Well, I'm going to guess, Barry, that because it's Uwe Rosenberg, I'm going to guess that you're going to say good. How about you, Brandon?
Uwe Rosenberg is my favorite designer. I refuse to believe that Barry is going to do anything but say this is the goods. So absolutely, you better give it a thumbs up or I might hang up.
Okay. We can cut this short show then. This short show. Oh, dear. Brain is mush. Let me just say that after playing, I was highly excited and played again.
Yeah.
And you know what? Happens. There was another game going on later on with my wife was playing and she had to run off somewhere. And so I filled in for her and that's how much I liked it. It's good. It's good.
Yeah.
It's Grinch good. I don't know. It's just so satisfying. Maybe I'm just getting old and like gardening and stuff like that. But it is just really satisfying filling up your board with all these lovely flowers. I'm quite opposed to putting the cats in. The cats are like a little one space filler. So if you've got like Tetris shapes, which you're not filling in properly, you can put a cat in there. And I hate that. But hey ho, that's part of the game. The scoring system is really ingenious as well. You've got two different scoring tracks and it's really, really, really fun. And I always seem to end up at the end of the game on the last round. There's something special happens, doesn't it? You remove any boards which haven't got anything on them. And I always seem to have two boards left. And so what happens on the last round, if you're still playing on the last round, you start losing points. And so there's this emphasis to get X amount of gardens done, but before a certain point in the game, because otherwise you'll start losing points. So it's really, really enjoyable. I need to save up where I ask Father Christmas to get this one, because this is a definite, great, simple, fun, flowery game. And I want some posies in my garden.
Have you played that already, Brandon?
This is the one title that I wanted at BGG Con that I missed. So I still have not played it, but I have an entire shelf back here of Rosenberg games. They're my fave, and I know that I'm going to love it without even playing it.
Yeah.
We just got our Feast of Odin in.
Good stuff, man. Great game.
I'm excited to try that.
Yeah, I've only got Agricola. But I love them.
So Brandon, do you have a game that you've been playing?
Yeah, I do. Let's do it. It's a nice big box here. Can you see the shrink is still on this because this is my brand new copy? But how about Cry Havoc?
Cry Havoc and let slip the dogs of war.
So I actually won this at BGG Con. I had not played it yet. So the day after I won it, I decided I should get someone to teach it to me. For anyone that hasn't played Cry Havoc, it is a asymmetric area control game. And by asymmetric, I mean that each player at the table has very different powers than everyone else. That means that this game takes a long time to explain and kind of a long time to digest the first few times you play it, because you're teaching everyone different abilities. Barry has an ability I don't have, and Kevin has an ability neither of us have. And, that makes it take a little bit of time to explain. It is very much an area control game, and I'm sure that everyone's very familiar with the way that sort of thing works. It does have one interesting mechanism that is really cool, and this conflict resolution board. Whenever a fight actually starts, you take all of your minis. You take all your minis off of that section, and then the attacker places them on this conflict resolution board. And you can kill each other. You can take people prisoner. There's different ways that you can resolve this conflict, and that's interesting. The other thing about this game that makes it a little different than a lot of the other area control type games is there is card play. So there's ways to actually draw cards, and then you play cards during conflict resolution and to mobilize your troops and that sort of thing. So Cry Havoc, it's been a big one this year. It's been hard to get, and that's why we didn't play it until last month. But what do you guys think I'm going to think about Cry Havoc? By the way, I want to preface this. Kimmet is my all-time favorite game, so you can utilize that as you digest this and decide whether I like Cry Havoc or not.
Good.
Kimmet. Yeah, I absolutely think you're going to say good.
Good.
And I'm going to just put this, I love Brandon because you love yourself.
I have been known to love myself, but we shouldn't talk about that on this show.
Is it because you're beefcake flavor?
That's why, yes, absolutely.
The beefcake.
So I almost wish that I would have gone a different direction because we all loved our stuff. Our show is about polarity, and this is not polarity, but this game it's awesome. I mean, it really is awesome. It takes something that I love, something that's very adversarial, like Kimmet, and it just kind of takes it up to the next level. I never thought that I would say that because I just love everything about Kimmet, but this game just does it. The card play is so good. The conflict resolution, which I talked about, is amazingly cool. It's such a simple thing, but it's so tactical, and it kind of adds a game within the game, and I really love that. Grant Rodiak is one of the main designers, and I exchange messages with him on Twitter all the time, and I do not have enough praise for how he's impacted potentially one of my favorite games of all times. I'm just pulled right now. I don't know what to do. Do I move my favorite game out of the top spot? What does that mean? I need more plays, but Cry Havoc gets my seal of approval.
Wow, that's amazing. How you've played it and it's still in shrink wrap, where mine's not in shrink wrap and I haven't played it.
Yeah, it was no, I played someone else's copy because that's one of the things is I'm the game learner and teacher in my group. Uh-huh. So anytime I can find someone to teach me a game, I am all over it. So when we're at a con, I'm just like, please teach me because I get tired of reading the books.
Yeah, I have a Josiah for that. My son teaches
champion me. Of the Star Wars Armada. Yes.
Yep. The Armada champion of world champion.
Yeah. Wow. Congratulations.
My son recently just won the world championships in Armada.
Look at that. Look at that proud dad. He got like 3 inches taller. His chest is puffed out. Wow.
And waxed.
It like the Grinch. My heart just grew. So, yeah, I played that with Cry Havoc. I'm still waiting for my copy. I haven't got it in yet, but I played a demo with Ignacy at Dice Tower Con, and that battle system is really unique. The way that's it amazing. Goes from the yeah, that's amazing, and just even you know the ramping up of your buildings and getting some abilities. I thought that was really unique too.
We'll have to review that one day.
Yes, we will. Little spoiler there for you. So I know there was a big debate, just real quick, you know, with Kemet. There was a big. I just got my insert from Daedalus. Have you seen that?
Insert what?
For Kemet.
It's a wooden insert for Kemet from Daedalus Productions.
No, I haven't seen it yet, but I guess I'm going to be emailing Ben right away because, again, my favorite game. And my minis are painted. One of our listeners painted all my minis. They're beautiful. So if that's a way to protect them, I want it.
It's fantastic. It took me a while to put it together, and I'm pretty good with wood, but it's a beautiful insert, and it's a watch it played. Rodney Smith has kind of cooperated with Ben on it, and nobody else has an insert out there. I love what all these people do. But
does it hold an expansion?
Yes, Talsetti. It does. Okay. It won't. It doesn't do the cross. Well, there's a little bit of extra room for the crossover stuff, but it might be a little smashed if you put some Cyclades stuff in there. But, yeah, anyway, the thing that I was going to just comment about that real quick, being you mentioned Kemet, Cry Havoc, a lot of people are saying, what is your favorite game? Cry Havoc, Blood Rage, or Kemet?
Sure.
And that's a big, you know, there's some comparisons there that it's really making people squirm a little bit. Because for me, Blood Rage is, I mean, I can't get enough Blood Rage, but I love Kemet. And, you know, I gave it a 5 on our Knights of Babylon. You remember, Barry?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And you gave it a 4, so it didn't make the table round table of Babylon. Thanks a lot.
No, I'm a golem. Yeah.
I'm not going to forget it. But Cry Havoc? Oh, is that going to – what's going to happen here?
Yeah, it's a great time to be a board gamer.
Yeah. All right. Well, with that, we are going to move right on to our – we have a new sponsor of the show. Arcane Wonders has graciously sponsored the Berkey and Badger Board Game Babble Show. And this is our live recording. Thank you very much. I'm going to do a read through of our sponsorship ad on the Pro Audio Edit. You're going to hear a more professionally produced ad. But for this, are you looking for a great Christmas gift this holiday season? Well, look no further. Arcane Wonders knows how to do Christmas. In partnership with Dice Tower Essentials, they have a fantastic lineup of Christmas gifts, from the ever-popular bluffing game, Sheriff of Nottingham, to the little abstract game that is like chess, Onitama. And if you're looking for a lightweight strategy game, Royals fits the bill. And if you want to scratch that party itch, there's a charades-like game called Speechless that's sure to be a hit. You can find these games at your local retailer or your online outlets. Also, check out arcanewonders.com. Wow. You think I had a radio voice or something, right?
Yeah, I reckon you should not pass. Yeah. Go direct to jail. Do not pass go.
Oh, I need some affirmation here.
Sorry. Affirmation.
Barry, affirmation, Barry.
That's a
story. Okay, so we're going to move right on to our game show, What Game is Behind the Door, with our special guest, Brandon Nall, from the Brawling Brothers Board Game Podcast. So, Barry, would you explain the game to us?
Okay. The game starts.
Explain it to me because I'm involved apparently, and I don't. Uh-oh.
I don't know how to do it actually.
He doesn't read rules. He's a liar.
Watch It Played made a video about this. Okay, that's all I need.
All right.
Did they?
Yeah.
Okay. The game show. We're gonna be quizzing Brandon here. We're going to be asking him three questions. The first question is, what is the last game that he purchased? The second question will be, what is the game that he's most excited about getting? And then the third question is, what is his current favorite game? But the thing is, we're going to be doing these in three different types of game style. So we're going to start. You ready, Brandon?
Let's do it.
With part one, what was the last game that you purchased? But don't tell us.
Oh.
We got to guess. All right. Okay, hopefully you've got the game there.
Games? What are we? We games? Oh. Of course I got this. Have you met me? Come on.
No, you live in old Texas.
I know. Oh. Come on down. Give you some barbecue and some green chili. I know you don't even know what that is, but
I know good. What green chili is, and I know what
no, you don't. Talk to Mr. Paul Grogan. We sent Paul Grogan with some delicious salsa. He'll tell you what real chili is, but
some jalapenos. We need some jalapenos.
All right, are we ready? I got this. I mean, yeah, I'm concerned that you guys aren't going to have this.
So that's how it goes.
We are going to ask him five questions each, and he will answer either yes or no, or maybe a which means in the middle. And then after each question, he will show us one component from this game. But hopefully it won't be red cube and then blue cube and then green cube. Hopefully it'll be.
You realize that I'm the guest here, right? And I can make up the rules as I go. Like they just seem like a suggestion when coming from you.
Gong him. Just gong him.
I'm going to gong him. we will babble along without him. I can mute him as well. So.
All right, go ahead, Barry. You ask the first question.
All right, I am not prepared. Okay. Boop doop 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 doop. Has this game come out in the last 3 years?
No.
No,
it says. Oh, you bought an old game.
I did.
Well, you like an old game. There's a difference there, Berkey.
Well, we'll have to see here, but okay. It definitely is an older game.
Okay, so component number one.
All right, are we ready?
Oh, wait a minute. No, Berkey asked the question.
I got to ask the component first.
Yeah, sorry.
Is this primarily a miniatures game?
No.
Okay, now it's component number one.
Are we ready? Here we go.
That's very professional. Ah, it's a gray.
Okay, man talk so people meeple. Can see it.
Yes, I'm talking.
No. Brandon has to talk so people can see it.
I can talk. So, what? Okay, well, what is it? What?
No, it's a meeple. I've got control of the camera.
Oh, I see. The camera. Okay.
This it is a radio show, okay?
It is It is a gray meeple. This, I don't know whose idea it is for us to have an audio or a video component to a damn radio show. Great thinking there, guys. You might want to rethink your game. But this is a gray dude. It's a gray dude.
Yeah, it's more of a dude than a meeple.
Okay. Okay. I see it.
I haven't got a foggiest. Unless it's that game. What's that game with you have to blow up everyone?
Like Manhattan Project? No, you don't blow anybody up in that
one. No. I can't think of it. It was a game. It was very, no. But anyway, moving on.
Your question there.
Okay. is this game a worker placement?
No.
Okay.
Worker placement? No. Is this a two-player game?
Yes.
Ooh. We have a yes. Component number two. The camera is on Brandon. Everyone can see.
Did you lock it in? I don't have to talk incessantly about
thing. No, you don't. No, I know how to do that. It's a little token. It's a money token. It says.
Oh, I know what it is.
Africano.
Yep. I know what it is.
Go on then.
Okay. This is what it is. I have it right here.
Everyone can see your behind.
I've at least you're wearing pants.
Not like you. Targi.
It is Targi. Good. An excellent job there by Berkey. And also, I gotta say, in the chat channel, someone guessed it right away. So, wow. one of the most underrated two-player games in existence. This game is really an excellent game. It's a cheap game, and I highly recommend it.
Okay,
it's a fantastic game. Yeah, Targi.
Well done, Kabuki Kid, for getting it correct.
Ah,
she's the girl.
Oh, right. She says it is worker placement.
I guess technically it is.
Yeah, because you're crossing. Yeah, okay.
The abstract element makes it less worker placement than normal, though, because you're not always sure exactly what you're going to be able to get. It's a very, very interesting design. And there's an expansion now, so hopefully we play that very soon.
It's a brand new expansion, or?
Yeah, it came out at Essen. It's not here in the States yet, but I can't wait until it is.
Oh, that's cool. See, we bring professionals on the show so that we can actually sound intelligent, even though we didn't say anything intelligent, but intelligent stuff happened.
Huh?
Okay.
Huh?
Okay.
Part two. What game is Brandon most excited about getting?
Okay. Oh.
And right. This part of the game, which... it's not very good for radio, but we'll make it good for radio. Brandon's going to draw us a picture, or he's probably already drawn a picture.
No, I haven't. This is going to be fun. I'm not a good artist. Yes, so this should be interesting.
We shall see. Okay, so we're going to have a couple of minutes to draw.
You guys just talk, and I'm going to draw a thing right now. It's going to be live.
Okay, draw your thing.
I think I'm going to do it in parts, though. So I'm going to draw a thing and then show you a thing, and then you guys can do a thing, and then I'll draw a thing again. So does that sound fun?
That sounds like
he's
changing our show to make it better.
I am the guest right now, so we got this. All right. So
new rules,
if I had a way to like live draw this, I would, but that would involve me messing with Hangouts. That's
live
not.
Draw. Sorry.
All right. So here we go. I'm actually drawing stuff right now.
Okay. Me and Berkey drawing about flowers. Or
no. Well, I think the Beefcake is actually a really good artist.
No, I'm not. I'm not actually. I do work in design, but freehanding and drawing in Adobe Illustrator, whole different deal. So trust me. No.
He's the backseat of board gaming.
It's real.
No, he's the Backstreet Boys of drawing board game stuff.
Okay. So, have you played Conan yet, Berkey, anytime?
No, you guys pay attention. Here we go.
Okay. Oh, no.
Sorry. Oh, there's clouds with lightning, I think. It looks like a cloud.
That's good drawing, right?
Coming really down. Good. Yeah. So, I knew what that was. So, lightning.
Okay. I thought it was a brain having a spasm.
It was. Yeah. It was a seizure.
Okay. I wonder if that's got something to do with gods.
The cloud could use some shadowing. Oh, and there's a very unhappy, sad-faced stick man underneath the cloud that's got lightning coming down from it.
Okay, yeah, no problems.
How are you guys doing? I feel like there should be some music. Like, do you have some drawing music for me? Or I mean,
yeah, Barry, come on, get on the board, Barry. Get on the board.
I can't do it live. Okay, I'll get the guitar.
That'll be better. Come on. Yeah, Bear's playing the guitar. Oh, Brandon, all he does is draw the board game show.
Wow.
Yeah.
Who else gets this treatment? This is amazing. All right, here we go. You ready? The final piece of my amazing puzzle here.
A church.
Ooh. There's a church with a steeple on it. We've got a sad person that's very large and not drawn well, so maybe he doesn't know how to draw.
Or maybe it's not. Maybe it's not to scale.
It's not to scale.
Nothing.
But he's excited.
Maybe there's a child underneath the table that's drawing it for him. You have any children?
I do. She's not here drawing it. She actually draws better than me.
Okay. Oh, I can scat, Kabuki Kid. Trust me, I can scat.
You can put it down now, Brandon.
All right, so Brandon. I drew this in two pieces for a reason. The question is, can you guys figure out why?
Because the game is going to be arriving in two pieces.
Okay.
It's a Kingdom Death monster.
With UPS like they are, it's possible that it arrives in two pieces.
Oh, gosh.
Okay.
I don't know. I'm just going to throw it out. I'm going to say Ohm.
I don't even know what that is. So you're wrong, sir.
That's the new game from R&R Games.
Right. That's right. I do remember seeing it at BGG.
It's got some of those buildings. But anyway.
All right. What about you there, Badger? Let's hear it. What's your guess? Look at this. It's a work of art. I'm actually going to sign this and send it to one of you guys.
Okay. Let's send it to the winner of this contest that we're just going to do right now.
Okay.
Anybody that knows this game in the chat, you're going to win this special drawing from Brandon Nall.
That's right. And I'll autograph it. It's going to be worth nothing eventually.
Oh, you can get a cup of coffee with it at Sambo's.
Nice.
As I said, the Banksy of board gaming. I haven't got a clue. I keep thinking of the comic book Preacher for some strange reason.
Oh, that's filmed here in New Mexico. Do you know that? Not old Mexico, New Mexico.
New Mexico. Ah. Ooh. That must be a new film. It's a series, isn't it?
It's based on a comic book. It is a series, yeah. Yeah, the film, it's being filmed here.
Okay. Wow. I haven't got a clue. I'm stumped.
Yeah, me too.
All right, well, I'll help you guys. You ready?
Okay.
Good.
This is a gloomy fellow.
Oh, yeah. I know what it is. Gloomhaven.
Gloomhaven, look at that. Gloomhaven, yeah. Yeah, my aura... Our review copy is on the way from Cephalofair Games. I'll have it on Monday, and I cannot wait to dig into potentially one of the biggest games of 2017.
I saw Paul Grogan is actually making a video of it right now, so that's going to be exciting.
I don't get it.
Gloom. I actually got to play a game of Spoils of War with Isaac Childress.
Yeah, Isaac's excellent. There's a hilarious picture on our Facebook of us all together at about 4:30, and Josh looks bewildered, Isaac looks confused, and I have a full lowball glass of whiskey, and I am quite happy. So it's worth checking out, that's for sure.
I thought you were gonna have salsa around your mouth or something.
Well, I should. I mean, that's that sounds delicious.
Jalapenos. Yeah.
Beefcake tastes nice with salsa.
Beefcake and jalapenos.
Well, you guys failed at that one. I mean, I made Targi too easy for you, but I figured that you would get it because, that was a really high quality drawing. It's a little sad that you guys couldn't
have that. I couldn't get the word haven from a church.
Yeah, well, that's it.
Nobody won it. Nobody won it. Oh, there's the beefcake with his glass of whiskey.
Look at Isaac. Look at Isaac. Yeah, he is like done with life. He's and really Josh, scared. I think maybe Josh has disgusted. Gas. There's something wrong here.
Yeah, he always has gas, but he's disgusted. He's got a smirk. His teeth are smirking. So he's a gaseous anomaly, that Josh.
On to the next thing. Are we ready?
Yes.
I'm gonna win this game. Yeah.
Okay. This is the question we're going to ask Brandon. What is his current favorite game? The one that he plays the most, the one that he dreams about playing while he's working, the one that he takes to bed at night and caresses the meeples inside.
Now we know it's not, you're not going to say Kemet because you already told us Kemet is your favorite game.
Right, but this is what I'm playing right now that's my favorite. Yeah. So check yourself. This is your show, not mine. I mean, you should know these rules.
We're just checking the rules because you'll be surprised how many people just budget up. I'm trying to think who. Was it Bonacore that fudged it up?
Oh, Bonacore.
Anywho. Okay, so Brandon's going to give us five one-word clues with spaces in between them. Or maybe I'm going to have to write that in this text as well. Leave space in between them. Don't just fire them. We're going to have a guess after each word.
Yep.
All right. So our first word is design.
Oh, God. Every design. Game is designed, so that could be every game in existence.
Yeah, he's a crafty one. He's a crafty design. Evil genius.
I got an evil genius drop. Whoa.
Yeah, you got the legendary Mike Fitzgerald and the evil genius Brandon Nall.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, Nall. Give us another one.
All right. Administration.
Administration. Good grief.
Administration let me down, but I'm still here. I'm still here. No, that's ruined my Rococo idea. I was thinking it was going to be because designing a dress and administration. What does that mean?
Well, yeah, right.
Is that to do with pasta?
You're a mean one, Mr. Grinch. You got cobwebs in your soul.
Is any of this related to your guys' guess, or is this just babble?
What? But that is the show. Okay. Sure. Give us another one.
All right. How about
board game sing song?
Yeah. How about recycling?
Okay. Now we're getting somewhere. Recycling.
I'm on a road to nowhere here.
Current game. Recycling. Spend resources. You make resources. I'm just gonna throw this out there to get it out there. I'm gonna say, administration. Okay, I'll save it. Give us another one.
I'm gonna have a guess. Power Grid, the card game.
No, but is that good? Because I haven't played it yet.
No,
I haven't either.
But I knew that you hadn't played that because I looked through all your playlists.
I knew it. And you know that I'm OCD and I keep that up. All right. Okay. How about next one? We ready here?
Yeah, fourth one.
We're ready.
Logistics.
Okay, I'm just going to guess scythe.
No, but it's scythe. But that's fine. I don't mean to correct you on your own show, but we have a problem speaking correctly, so I try to spread awareness.
Could you just gong him? We're gonna edit that crap out, right?
You're gonna spread it just like wax on a chest.
Wow.
The beefcake wax chest.
I'm trying to think. I can see the game in my head. It's a stronghold game, one with the boat. What's it called? Not Kanban. Panamax. Or Pinimix.
Is that's your guess?
That's my guess.
No. You are looking through my playlist, though, so you need to stop that.
Yeah, I'm sure I'm looking through your playlist on Board Game Geek. Your name is
Beefcake.
Yeah.
Beefcake.
All right. Beefcake. Are we ready for it? We had a very weak guess of scythe, and we had a weak guess.
Now it turned into insult.
Yeah. I'm sorry. This is how. Have you listened to our show? This is how we do.
Okay. Things, this is so. How it goes.
All right.
Find my glass.
My last guess. No. My last hint. My last hint is.
Yeah, they're all guesses.
Is Sandra.
I know what it is. It's Kanban.
It is Kanban. Absolutely.
Cassandra's the gal that we're all, yeah. I love Kanban.
Yeah, Barry was there, but he didn't go with it. He, you know, so he missed out, but it is Kanban. Kanban is one of my favorite games right now, and it has been for a couple of months for sure.
Wow, it slipped through my fingers.
Yeah, you were right there. I was like, no. And that's why I wanted to make sure that was your final answer, because I didn't want you going back on it.
That was awesome.
Well done. That's very interesting. Can you tell us a bit about Kanban then?
Kanban is a Vitel Lacerda game. He's also known, of course, for Gallerist and Vinos. And right now, Lisboa's on Kickstarter, which is looks like it's going to blow my mind. It's a very Kanban's a very heavy game where you actually are a factory worker and you're in charge of producing cars and testing them and upgrading their systems. And again, super duper heavy. Most games of this weight don't have theme that makes a lot of sense. They're themeless in a lot of instances. Lacerda's games are not like that. These games are heavy and they're just theme rich. Every mechanism in Kanban makes sense in terms of developing and producing these cars. And it is it's a beast to learn. It is a fiddly mess on the table, but it's just such a rewarding game. It's the ultimate exercise in min-maxing and efficiency. So if you haven't played Kanban, I love the game and recommend you play it.
Oh, absolutely. I have to concur. My son taught me the game, but this is, you know, generally a heavier game. I have to play it a while before I really get into it. I'm a little bit of a slow learner on the heavy games. This game, once he taught it to me, everything just made sense. This game is so beautifully designed. For me, everything was just a real natural progression and how we were collecting things. Love the game. I think it was really well done. I highly agree. If you have any tolerance at all for learning a heavy game, this is very rewarding.
Cool. I'll have to look out for that if it ever comes over here.
You can play it, Barry. I'll plug it. You can actually play it on Bodejo, and I think that's the only site right now. So if you want to play it online or learn it online.
Sorry, what was that? Bodejo?
Yeah, I don't know. It's some French game. There you go. The French guy.
I hate
I actually, when I, when if I don't have a bookmark, I actually have to Google French board games online because I have no damn clue how to spell it. So
Yes, I knew that.
It's an excellent, excellent game, and that's a great way to learn it because it's less fiddly because the computer tells you what you can and can't do. And I'm actually playing a game with a couple of my friends all over the U.S., so it's a good way to get in there.
Okay.
Awesome.
But if you like it, you should buy a copy so we don't take any money out of Stronghold's pockets. So go buy a copy. It's a great game.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
That's the idea of the game.
Well, we're going to move right on to our Babble topic called Christmas shopping.
It's time for the
Babble, Birky and Badger's board game Babble.
Words come out my mouth there.
I saw eyebrows going up in the air.
That's my dancing. That's the equivalent of my dancing.
That's your chair dancing. Well, we're just going to talk about Christmas. We're going to talk about, you know, where you side on Christmas. Are you the Grinch or are you that happy, happy little kid that's trying to shoot his eye out with the Red Ryder BB gun?
Yeah. Depending what film that's from.
That's the Christmas story.
Ah, yeah.
And what's your favorite Christmas story, Brandon? What's your favorite Christmas movie, real quick?
Me?
Brandon.
I think Brandon. Maybe A Christmas Story. What about, or no, you know what? I'm not going to cop out like that. What about National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation? That's a great one.
Yeah.
I love
it. Yeah, yeah.
Chevy Chase is so funny, and we have to watch that every year. My wife hates it. I don't care. It's like, it puts me in the mood.
Absolutely.
I have a toss up between two. It's either The Muppets Christmas Carol, because it's the Muppets. Come on, look. Muppets. Yes.
Animal.
Or Die Hard.
Die Hard's a good one. But a lot of people would argue that's not really a Christmas movie. I'm on your page. I think it is, but.
It is a Christmas movie.
Yeah.
I have two of them, and we watch them every year. But it's absolutely Jim Carrey, the Grinch that stole Christmas. Absolutely the best. But the other one is the Christmas Carol, but it's the Patrick Stewart version. Yes, exactly.
That's exactly what I was going to say. So well done there, sir. Well done.
So So, okay, so we're going to talk about Christmas. So, what camp do you fall in, Brandon? Do you love Christmas? Do you love this time of year, or do you dread this kind of year?
So I used to work in video games, and I hated this time of year because it was nuts. I was a regional manager for GameStop, and this time of year was exhausting for me. And that's gone now because I own my own business and I do board game talk, and I love this time of year. Though I got to tell you, and I'm completely confessing here, I am not in the Christmas spirit this year. I have a lot of stuff going on, a lot of excellent distractions, and I'm just having a hard time getting into the Christmas spirit. So we're putting up decorations this weekend, and I'm hoping that that does it, but I've been playing Christmas music and trying to watch stuff on TV whenever I have a few seconds, and I need help getting in the Christmas spirit.
Just watch a couple Hallmark movies with your wife and you'll be right in there.
I don't know how that's going to go, but okay, I'm going to give it a shot, and I'm going to tell her that you recommended this.
Well, this is the problem in my home. My daughters and my wife, they're watching Hallmark all the time, and I can tolerate one of them.
After that, you're done, huh?
The wife or the daughters?
No, I tolerate the wife. Oh, boy, after one, here we go. Done. There you gotcha. Go.
You're going to be in trouble, too.
Thanks a lot, Barry.
Yeah.
How about you, Barry?
I walk out the room when Hallmark's on. It's just so depressing.
Are you a Scrooge, Barry? Are you a Scrooge, or are you all?
I'm much like Brandon. I used to be a Scrooge because I used to work in retail. So my shop had to play Christmas music from the beginning of December right up to the end of December. And then you had to put up with all the customers and all the empty shelves. And then after Christmas, it was the worst time because everyone would bring everything back because it didn't fit.
Brutal. So it was a horrible time in my life.
It was a horrible time in my life. And I mean, yeah, there were 500 different Christmas songs, probably more in the world, but you'd hear the same ones all day.
These are a few of my favorite things.
Oh, dear. But Christmas is better now I'm in France because they don't have so many Christmas songs in France. You know, there's probably a little bit of George Michael and there's a little bit of George Michael. But that's about it.
He's big there, huh?
Yeah, he's big there. So there's no, like, Mel and Kim singing whatever. You wouldn't know Mel and Kim was, would you?
I have no clue what you're talking about.
Kim Wilde.
I still am shaking my head yes, but I have no clue what you're saying.
Okay, so yeah. I like Christmas now. It's a lot more familiar. It's a lot more calmer than it used to be. It used to be a rush because, as I said, working in retail, you had no time to do anything. You'd come home one day a week.
Yeah, was my life. And it was 14-hour days for me. So it took something out of it. So a quick message, I mean, PSA to all your listeners and your viewers, be nice to people when you're out there because it's a hard time of year to work out there in that. Yeah. No one is friendly. Everyone is cranky. Everyone's in a hurry. There's long lines. Be nice to the people that are helping you because Christmas is not their favorite time of year. So make it a little better for them.
Mm-hmm. Oh, good point. Good point. Yeah, you don't ever know what you know. Sometimes the holidays is a downer for different people. You know, they have different experiences that have happened to them. If someone has lost a loved one over the holidays, this is a very difficult time for them. For me, Christmas is always such a great, joyous time. It's full of tradition with our family. We make a big Christmas Eve dinner, and we change up the old turkey routine, and we make meat instead. You know, turkey's kind of meat, but not it's white meat, and we want red meat. So we make lamb and we make prime rib and sometimes we'll throw some shrimp in there and it's all got all of our special Happy Mouse seasoning on it, of course. So we do.
By the way, my turkey had your Happy Mouse seasoning on it at Thanksgiving. So well done, sir.
Ah,
very tasty. Good? It was delicious.
Ah, cool. Yeah, it's we love the Christmas time. On Christmas Day, my wife makes this chicken noodle or turkey noodle soup with homemade noodles, these big honking noodles that are just like, it's so awesome. We look forward to it
they're
every year.
They're actually donuts. They're not noodles. They're donuts.
Well, we like donuts here too. But Christmas is a great time. So let's ask a couple questions here. Barry, feel free to chime in. But do you have a big list of board games that you want,
Brandon? Oh.
I chimed in.
Yeah, I do. I actually have a big list, and I have to be careful because, as you can see from the wall behind me, it gets out of control and it's hard to find time to consume everything. But there's a couple of things, and I keep plugging Bonacore. I don't know why, but Great Western Trail is at the very top of my list. I adore Alexander Pfister. Everything that he touches is gold. He is one of the most diverse designers of today, and I think he probably could be, you know, the Stefan Feld of now. Great Western Trail looks to be everything I love in games, including an Old West theme, and that's at the very, very top of my list for sure.
Yeah, have you played it yet? Or
I haven't, and I'm hoping that it's under the Christmas tree. It looks great. What about? I mean, there's just so much. I got. I told you my Secret Santa got me Venus Deluxe yesterday. That was just super duper exciting. Another game that I really want is Inish, which the new Madagascar game, and it's. It's Kemet-ish, so I'm really interested in it, but the art is so beautiful in that game. So if right now, if I had to really nail it down, those would be the two games at the top of my wish list.
How about you, Barry? Do you have a wish list?
No, I don't. I've got too many games still to play from Essen, so... Essen was my Christmas, so I have no wish list. It's probably new headphones, because these are... falling apart, and that's about it.
Yeah, it's kind of the same thing for me. It's BGG Con. I picked up a few games. I've gotten a few review copies that I need to get to, and then I did a huge math trade, and I got like 10 different games that are sitting on my shelf of shame, looking at me. You know,
you're gonna need to build a shed of shame. I think
a shed of shame. Yes. Well, I was thinking about, could you do like the 12 days of Christmas, like every day? We determined to learn a new game and play it, one that's sitting on that shelf. I don't know if I could do it, to be honest with you.
I could do it, but it's finding the time to play it. I can learn a game a day. I probably do that right now anyway, but playing it is a whole different deal.
Yeah, that's my problem. And learning the game is my problem too.
But buying it is not a problem. You just, whoop, there's a game. Am I
going to
put this?
Feast of Old. You guys are sure. Old. All right. Go ahead, Barry. You got some more questions for us?
Yes. Yes. You've added some questions to the list. Sexy. Yes.
Surprise.
I did. See?
Do you do a Secret Santa?
Yeah, I mean, so I've chimed in. I'm in three. I'm crazy. I'm in absolutely crazy, but I'm in a tight-knit group. There's about, I don't know, there's 15 of us that go to Origins together. We're all doing an exchange. My show, The Brawling Brothers, is doing an exchange, which there was 40 people in that one. And then I'm in the BGG Secret Santa, which is, you know, 4,000 people worldwide. And it's always exciting. I'm that guy. It's more about me making someone else's stuff great than what I receive. It's exciting for me to get something, but I love to send Christmas cheer. That makes me feel good. And if you haven't done these, they're awesome. Do them.
Okay. Are you doing one, Barry?
No.
Wow. Grinch.
I am a Grinch.
You're a mean one. You got cobwebs in your soul.
I don't know. It just doesn't appeal to me. I don't know. Seems like too much work, and it is nice to always give something to someone else. That thing I can appreciate, and that's what I try to do every Christmas. Is I try to slip a few board games into someone's present to try and get them to go our way. So I did it my way.
The gateway drug.
Yeah, it's a gateway drug. And why not? Because I mean, there's a lot of great, fantastic board games out there. And yet someone will buy you socks or someone will buy you a tablet. Yeah.
A tablet.
Yeah. A tablet, you know, a pad, an iPad. Sorry.
That's so 2015.
Yeah. I know.
That's lame.
I know. And that's why we're doing this Babble topic, is because we want to talk about What games do you buy for your non-gamer friends?
I haven't actually done a Secret Santa thing, but I've got several people that I send things to, kind of unbeknownst to them. So I haven't gotten into one where I'm receiving anything, but I had something recently just happen that is kind of like this, but really, like you said, Brandon, getting this feeling of, wow, I'm doing something special for someone else. You know, I love those feelings, and not that that's about our feelings, but about generally wanting to do this. And I ended up connecting with a guy. I sold him a Catan box. I made this custom wood box for putting all of your Settlers of Catan stuff in. Sold it on eBay to the guy. Long and short of it, the address came up, wouldn't go through my FedEx because it was from an APO. And at the moment, I wasn't quite sure what was going on with that. Found out that I texted the guy and said, you have a different address. FedEx won't take it. And he says, well, this is the deal. I'm stationed in Afghanistan. And he's in a medevac unit. And I said, oh, dude, thank you so much for your service. And, you know, the shipping cost was going to be more and different things. And I just said, hey, I got it covered. Thank you so much. And so I sent him the box. But then I also threw in a couple of packages of my Burke's Happy Mouse signature spice. Ding. You're going to have to ding that one now.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
So anyway, I send it to him. This guy gets back to me on Facebook, and he says, dude, you don't know what this means to me. His name is Charlie Wilkins. And Charlie, if you ever listen to this, you know, thanks again so much for your service and what you guys do. It's amazing. But he said, I haven't been able to enjoy food. And for the last 2 months, and all of a sudden food has taste again. We became, well, I don't know what they're eating there, but
that's the ultimate ad for
it. Set your taste buds free. But anyway, we became Facebook friends, and I ended up adopting the whole unit. There's 40 of these guys, and they're two different heirs, one in Kandahar, one in Bahrain. And I sent them a great big box of bunch of Happy Mouse signature spice. And it was just like, you know, I couldn't be more thrilled about it. I am like, if I could do something just a little bit to make their lives better. And here it was at Christmas too. It was just like, it's like the Grinch. Your heart moves three times bigger, just knowing that you're helping, even if it's such a piddly thing, but in another way, it's meaningful, you know?
Yeah. Well, that's really sweet of you.
Well,
that's what it's all about, the Christmas spirit.
It's what they're doing for us. But so
my Christmas spirit's in my cellar in bottles.
Ah, you can send some of that here. Brandon will take some of it.
Yes, sir.
He works at a very, very famous champagne company. You do know.
Oh, no, I had no clue. But now I feel like we're becoming closer right now. You know, our bond has grown, sir.
Oh. Hello, beefcake. How are you?
I'm mildly uncomfortable, but it's fine. I'm good. Thank you. Thank you for asking.
So let's talk about where you get your presents if you're buying board games. Are you buying your board games from big box stores? Or are you buying them from your local board game store, your friendly family board game store? Or are you buying online?
Everyone's going to hate me, but I am the online shopper. I don't do a good job of supporting our friendly local stores. I should do better probably, but I live a very long way away from our nearest local store, and it's easier for me to put in an order with Cool Stuff or Mini Mart. I spend a lot of money with them, and they treat me really well. Anyone that hasn't dealt with Cool Stuff in particular, man, they will bend over backwards to make stuff right for you, and it's a good experience for me. So I am super guilty of shopping online almost exclusively.
Mm-hmm. I am an online shopper. I love doing Christmas shopping online. But when it comes to board games, I know that special place to go. The Alchemist. Nice. The Alchemist is the place to go to get my games. So
Tell us about The Alchemist.
The Alchemist is on the outskirts of Reims. It's a very small shop. It's run by one lady. But the good thing is they It's a building which has is part of a block, and it has a sign designer next door. And so in the night, the sign designer, who is her husband, lets her use that whole area as a gaming area. So every night there is game night at the Alchemist.
Wow.
As I said, it's a very small shop. It's probably a bit bigger than my room.
Which we can't see, so that's great. Excellent. See, great. Very so, good yeah. radio. You're good at
okay,
this.
Okay. Eight meters by 6 meters.
Oh, he's using meters. No one that's listening to this knows what a meter is.
Oh, God. I'm being outshone here. Well, I'll quit. You can call it Berkey and Brandon's board game babble. I'm going. Mr. Perfect for radio.
Sorry.
We don't have a what I would refer to as a local friendly game store. We have kind of a game store, but it's not much anymore. Titles are very old and it's not always the most friendly. I think the guy's kind of burnt out with the whole situation, and he mostly just will complain about online. And while I recognize that's a horrible situation, you know, to compete against, on the other hand, I really believe that you could do it right. I think you can provide diversification with the type of games, the type of food offerings you make, making the place inviting for gamers, to create an atmosphere that is an experience. And so if I had that, I really would support it.
Yeah.
I would probably have to buy less games, but that would be okay with me. I would rather buy less games, support it if there was something good locally. But Brandon, I'm with you, and I know it's a bold thing to say, but I have to buy mostly online.
Yeah. And we are, we're always open to online e-tailer sponsoring our show. So now you know that we shop exclusively online. Send me an email.
So you're a level niner at cool stuff, just like myself, right?
Yeah, it's out of control. It's embarrassing how much money I spend with them. But again, they treat me right. So I don't know why I would do anything else.
Yeah, but my local game store treats me right. And I'm not in there spending 500 euros every month.
What's a euro?
A euro.
Euro. It's a euro.
Oh, Kevin.
Yes, yes, yes. I made Brandon laugh.
We're going to get a French guest star next time. I'll probably get Bruno Catalo or something like that.
Okay, well, now you're big. Now you're name dropping, so knock that off, okay?
Okay. Well, Bruno is his good friend, you know.
Excellent.
So what percentage of games do you said mostly exclusive then that you buy? And I would probably say I've bought about 70%, and the rest is I'll buy at conventions. That's one thing that's a little, you know, it's expensive to buy at the convention, but if I realize the cost that these publishers have at these conventions too are mm-hmm. just outrageous for their booth, especially Gen Con. And if I can help them, and I can pick up a game that I really want, I like to do that. So I try to do that best I can. I'm on a limited budget, so I don't have unlimited resources. But so I have to be frugal. But I'm let my list of games that I need has become less and less and less. I have so many games. I'm kind of at that place where I kind of need to get rid of some games because I just don't get to play them. And I want to play the new relevant things that are happening, but the same point, I don't always have to own all of them.
Hey man, I'm on your page. I actually just purged, and I noticed that you've been purging, but I sold about 150 games, and I ordered a table from boardgametables.com with the proceeds from my purge. So I'm excited about that.
That's incredible. 150 games.
150 games, yeah. And look at this ridiculousness still. Like, I could sell another 150 and still have too many.
I've got 20 on the floor ready to sell, and I can't get rid of them.
How many are in your collection?
I was at 500 before I started. So, you know, I was down probably to 350. I'm probably up to 400 now because I'm a very frugal person. I'm a very value conscious person. So a lot of what I do is buying secondhand, trading. I love math trades. That's how I met you, Berkey, is last year. I bought a copy, or I traded for a copy of Medina, and you gave it to me at BGG Con.
Oh, that's right. I totally forgot that. That's right.
Yeah, it's actually sitting up there. You want to know something crazy? I still haven't played the damn thing. I mean, this is the problem. This is the problem, right? I mean, yeah,
it's the problem. I got games from 2 years ago that I did.
So I probably only 60% of my collection is purchased. The rest purchased from an e-tailer or a retailer. The rest is traded or bought secondhand, because board games are awesome like that. They really have this extended life where they can switch hands many, many times, and board games do hold their value. My wife hates it when I say that, but I just sold 150 games and bought a beautiful new table. I mean, most people wouldn't dream of being able to get their money back out of games, but you really can.
Yeah. So, friends of Brandon, if you're listening, buy him a secondhand game.
Yes, please. That's fine. I'm good at it. I'm very particular about my stuff, so it better be perfect. But otherwise, yes, secondhand.
Well, what we're gonna do? We're gonna close up this segment by giving you all some of our recommendations for Christmas gifts. The concept was more for non-gamers. Now, those of you that are, you know, gamers, you kind of know what are gateway games. So, but we just wanted to give you an idea of some different types of games that would be great for Christmas. And with that, why don't we just go one at a time? We'll just go back and forth from Brandon, Barry, DeBerkey, the three B's, the Better Business Bureau of board gaming. And we will give you our list. So Brandon, why don't you start us off with some of your top five not games to give non-gaming friends?
Yeah, this is an easy list for me, because while I do like heavier games, my group loves stuff that we can just sit down and play. Number one on this list for me, should I go top to bottom?
Start from five and go to one.
All right, I'm going to go to five. I think you should buy Kanban for every... No, I'm sorry. That's not a good one.
I was thinking Twilight Imperium.
A game that came out this year that really has stole the show for me. There's two of them, actually, but the first one is Imhotep from Cosmos. Imhotep is excellent. It is not heavy. It is simplistic, and you can teach it in 10 or 15 minutes. And it's like a heavyweight fight. It's a slugfest. It's trading blows. It's very in your face, and anyone can be competitive at it. I think Imhotep is a home run. It's also under, I think the MSRP is $34.99 or something. So great game.
Okay. Yeah, good game.
Right. One thing about my list before I say what my number five is, is that four of my five can be bought in big stores, because that was going to be some of the conversation that we were supposed to be babbling about, the big stores versus our local gaming store. So four out of the five games that I have on my list can be bought at big stores here in France. So I'm talking Toys R Us, I'm talking Pickwick, and I'm talking your local garage as well. Some of these games you can buy at your local garage. My number five is Time's Up, which is a party game.
Great game.
Which it's one of those games that a non-gamer will look at and go, I don't want to play this. But you get it out and you start doing it and you start playing it quickly. After the first round, there's some giggles. After the second round, people just want to keep playing. And after the third round, you just want to play again. So it's small, it's light. It comes in different flavors as well. It comes in Berkey Happy Mouth flavor.
Yeah, yum.
And it comes in different categories. So you can have history, or you can have pop culture, films, things like that. So yeah, Time's Up, light party game, which everybody can get into.
I've never played it. I've heard good things.
It's a good one. We played last year at BGG Con, and we played for about 4 hours straight. And there's some great pictures of everyone at the table in stitches, just absolutely crying. It's excellent stuff.
Yeah.
Well, I have a game too that can be purchased recently at a big box store, because it just recently got into Target. This is a great stocking stuffer type of game as well, and it's from the designer Chris Leader. And it's
rolling?
The game.
Are you rolling? You're rolling for it.
Roll for it. That's right. We're rolling.
Okay.
one of my daughter's favorite games. It was it's easy to introduce, man.
It, that's the thing that's so great about it. For beginning gamers, New Year's Eve will have a lot of people over, and a lot of them are beginning gamers. And I can always pull out Roll for It. It's very simple to get. You're basically just rolling dice to get what's on the card that's out in front of everyone. And everybody is competing for that card that's going to give you points. So it's simple. I have the deluxe edition, which is really cool with all eight, so I can play up to eight people. And it's got the fancy artwork from Calliope Games. It's in a tin. That's really neat. Target has this game for like $11.99 in a new package that's slightly more generic. But nonetheless, it's accessible and a great gateway game.
Mm-hmm. Number four.
Back to me. All right, so I'm gonna cop out completely here. This is one of my all-time favorites. It was part of my gateway into board games, and everyone's favorite is Carcassonne. I mean, it's unbelievable how great this game is and how easy it is to get someone to sit down and do it. And then the thrill, that the dopamine just trickling through as you reach into that bag and pull out that tile and you're trying to figure out what to do with it. It does such a great job of showing people what board games can be at a very simplistic level.
Yeah, absolutely. It's great with as a two-player game too.
Yeah, I have bought that for presents as well, so Christmas, so it's gone down well.
All right, Barry.
Number four for me is that game which people hate drawing, will draw, and that's Telestrations. This game just goes down like a bomb, especially if it's a Christmas present. People open up and they go, what's this? Oh, I don't like drawing games. Get out the cards. Right. Write your first word. Okay. And then the giggles come out and you'll be that they'll be shouting, holy crap, this is fun, because it is just a word game, a Chinese whispers. A word turns into a picture, which turns into a word, which turns into a picture. And at the end, the picture or the word are completely different from what you started with. And it's just, you know, nonsensical fun, very much like Time's Up. Just a party game, best with four players. Sorry, not best with four players, but with four players plus. Fun, 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 fun. And it, awesome. it can be bought anywhere.
Yeah. Yeah, my game is, I think it's become kind of a classic, especially within hobby circles, but you're starting to say, I know this is kind of a love fest for Stephen Bonacor and Stronghold Games today, but one of the games that my family has always loved is Combo. Survive, Escape from Atlantis. Not Combo.
I mean, I like your list, Kevin. This is one of our favorites. This is one of the meanest games on earth, but it's so simple, and everyone at the table has a good time with Survive.
Yeah, I'm taking it to games night tonight, so looking forward to playing it.
Well, we have all the expansions for it, and we got the squids and the sharks are running around, and the island is shrinking, and yes, it has that take that element, but this is one of those take that games that my family, we don't get upset about. We're all just in there going after it. We can never remember what the number on the bottom of our little survivor is anyway. So we have a blast with that. And I know this is kind of a evergreen title for Stronghold Games. When we talked to Steven, he said they still sell more of this game than any other game that they've had.
I believe it. Yeah, it's a really great game.
Sure. And they've got the new space theme game as well. And what was it called? Mars Attack? Survive Mars Attack, I think. That's just basically the same thing with the Engelsteins. Jeff Engelstein, their family, redesigned it a little bit. But it's basically Survive Atlantis in space. So
on to the next. So my number three is this is the end of my 2016 love affair, but this is, in my opinion, one of the best games to come out this year. So simple, but everyone loves it. That is a little game from Haba called Karuba. Karuba is amazingly good. Karuba is like path building bingo if you haven't played it. It's it's a brilliant little game typically when we play it, we play three or four games back to back to back. Everyone loves it. You're an explorer on an island, and you're trying to get a light color explorer to a light color temple to explore it and get the treasure from it. All the while, someone's drawing tiles from a bag, and you have to lay a tile on your board that matches the tile they drew, and this tile creates paths. So you're trying to make paths from point A to point B and get everyone out quicker than everyone else. It's awesome, simple to play. Again, nice cheap price point. You know, it's not exactly a party game like a couple of the games on your guys' list, but I think this is a good game to really introduce people to the hobby.
I got another game. My number three is a game, again, which non-players I've seen say, I'm not playing that. And they watch the game and they're playing the game at the same time. They're behind another person saying, no, don't put it there. Don't put it there. Put it there. Put it there. Put it there. No, it doesn't go there. Ah, too late. And that is Timeline or Card Line. Very, very small, lovely little tin box. Comes again, lots of different flavors. So if you're into history, there's one for history. If you're into science, there's one for science. There's one for your countries as well now. So you can get an England one, an American one. Hopefully they're not racist. but it's a fun card game. It's very, very, very simple. People love playing it. And as I said, people even that don't like to play games will play this because they'll be behind someone telling them what to do. And then eventually they'll get their bum sat at the table and they'll be playing the next round. So Card Line, Timeline.
Timeline. Yeah, you know, this was a, you know, there's certain titles that I think we would probably, as gamers, would all agree are gateway games. And the one that came to mind for me that I'm not going to choose, but was Ticket to Ride. Obviously, it's fantastic. You guys may have chosen that. I don't know. But I wanted to just go a little bit outside of the norm of what we know. And the reason I went slightly outside is I went with the game from Asmodee called Abyss. Abyss has this type of set collection. And the artwork of this game is fantastic. But I've played this with new gamers, and we've been able to teach this game really quickly. It's beautiful when it lays out, and it is this introduction to, hey, board games are more than just roll and move. They're beautiful artwork. There's all this stuff going on with a little bit of player abilities, and yet it's not that complex. And love Abyss. My family loves it. I think it's a great gateway game.
I can see little Tabitha. You go, hello, Tabitha. Happy Christmas, my dear. Oh, thank you. Oh, that's really nice.
Yeah, so I'll chime in a little bit. Some of the prettiest artwork. I mean, it's striking how good the artwork is in Abyss. Beautiful game.
You just want to watch. You just want to look at it. You don't even want to play the game. You just want to analyze it. It's so awesome.
You wouldn't want to read the rules either. So.
No. It's you have me for that. Why would you want to read the rules? That's what
the beefcake.
I'm so glad no one took my game, because this is a game that my group has played more than any other game in the last 18 months or however long. And that's Codenames. Codenames from CGE is I have a feeling
curse you, beefcake. Curse you, beefcake.
Stole ya. I have a feeling that this game is timeless and it's just gonna keep going. So every group, it doesn't matter if there's gamers or not. It doesn't matter if it's someone that's cranky or someone that loves to laugh. This is a game that you can safely buy for anyone. And now, you know, you have options now. You have the standard Codenames. You have Codenames Pictures. You have Codenames Deep Undercover, which is an adult-themed one. Yeah, I mean, there's options. And this is a great franchise for CGE. They're going to continue to do gangbusters with it, but really great game. So whose thunder did I steal?
I think you stole Berkey's.
You stole my thunder.
Sorry.
And lightning and Codenames.
I was going to put Codenames on the list, but out of all the games that I've played, my list is games that I've seen people who don't normally play games just come along and just go, wow, this is great. Codenames is not one of those. Unfortunately for me.
You're a old fuddy-duddy. That's what's
going on. I'm not fuddy-duddy. I think
you don't know fun.
I'm just going to go out of order.
I'm not messing with the beefcake. Okay, my number two is an elegant abstract strategy game.
I'm not messing with the beefcake.
I'm not brawling with the beefcake. is an abstract strategy game. This is the only one on the list that you cannot find in a big store here in France. And it plays from 2 to 8 players. And it is Suro, which is the Path of the Dragons game.
Oh. If you know the
one. Yeah. It's very, 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 very simple. It's a tile laying game. You'll be laying a tile out in front of your dragon, and it's got roads on it, and you follow these roads. And each time you've got to try and make sure that you stay on the board, because if you come off the board, you're eliminated from the game. This game plays in about 10 minutes. And as I said, it plays up to 8 players, and anybody can play. You can teach your grandmère. Grandmère, I'm saying it in French. Grandmère. I can't even say it in English now.
Grandma. It's fine.
Grandmother.
I mean, there's so many problems with you being there and us not knowing what you're talking about. Grandma. Grandma.
A granny.
How about a granny?
Granny. That's better.
Meemaw.
Agree. Yeah, we. Anana. Anana.
Yes, yes.
So, yeah, there you go. My number two is Suro.
Suro of the Seas. Yes, or Suro the Dragon.
Yeah, there's two versions.
Yep. Oh, excellent. Well, mine was codenamed, so I won't talk much about it, but accessible, great gateway game. This is a New Year's Eve game for us for sure. It plays nicely. It scales nicely with 4, 6, 8 people. Pitchers just came out. It's small footprint. Great to take along with you traveling. So it's a great game.
And it won't scare you when you open it.
No fear. It's no very, fear. Very mellow art.
No fish.
Yep.
All right, okay, number 5.
I like that I get – it's my number one. I like that I get to go first here because I might steal someone's something. But this is a top 10 game for me. This is something we talk about a lot on our show. I think the best game to buy non-gamers to get them into this crazy-ass hobby is Mysterium. Mysterium is an amazing experience, and we just – keep playing it over and over with people who've never played games, and everyone loves the stress of this game. They love the artwork. They love the components. People know Clue. They're familiar with that. You know, people have played Dixit. That's a familiar thing. You combine all those things, put them in one, and it's a beautiful package.
I totally forgot about Dixit. That would have been a good one. Yeah, good choice. Good choice. Oh, my number one is a game that is it's played all the time when I take it to game night. I'm going to take it again to game night because unfortunately there'll be people there that will say, where is it? And that's Quirkle, which is the Scrabble equivalent of colors and shapes, or the shape and color equivalent of Scrabble. Yes, it's simple. It's just that simple concept that you're playing Scrabble, but you don't have to spell. And it's just really, really a mind-absorbing combat, so to speak. I've seen these old dears at our club just go at it when they play correctly. It's like, oh, right, you're not writing down the score correctly. Oh, yes, I am. No, you're not. No, I got 15 there because that's a Quirkle and plus those there. It's like, but, very, very, very simple. but it always causes a fight between the old dears because they just hate losing against each other. So my number one non-gamer game is Quirkle.
Quirkle. Mm. Well, my number five, we just recently played this. My son brought two of his engineering student friends from college. They were not big gamers at all. They hadn't played many games. This game is a little bit, I would say, group dependent. If you have people who are just real analytical and not real enjoy interaction with each other, this game might not be the game. So if you're buying this for someone else, make sure that they have some personality. And I'm going to give you a clue by showing you a component. Ah, here it comes.
Blood Rage.
You're shilling right now. That's what's happening, Kevin. You are shilling.
Baby, I have many shillings at Prince John's feast. Of course, it is Sheriff of Nottingham, the good sheriff, of course. and he is minding the feast. Well, the Sheriff of Nottingham, in my opinion, is a fantastic gateway game for teaching bluffing and this type of thing, because every time we play this, we have so much fun. And I've brought this to so many different places. Even my father, who's just a card player, he loves playing poker and cribbage and these kind of things. I get him and his wife, and they're in their 70s, and they're playing this game and having a great time. It's easy to teach. You know, you're basically collecting some sets and trying to bring them into the feast, and you're bluffing your way and bribing your way back and forth. So the social interaction is always a hoot. There's double bluffing. The group that we just played with here the other night, you guys know Arcane Wonders is sponsoring us. Thank you very much. But I love this game, and it had nothing to do with that. I love this game before I knew them. And it's just a fantastic game. It's readily accessible. You can find this online for $25. They've sold 140,000 copies of this game. It's a Dice Tower Essential. So Tom Vassell speaks highly of it as well. And I just say that to say is I think this is a great gift item because it looks beautiful. It's just great.
Good choice.
There we have it. So
I mean, that's some great stuff for everyone to buy if you're needing something to help get someone in the hobby. That's 15 awesome games. Every one of those is great.
Mm-hmm. We only have one crossover. That's remarkable, and that just tells you just how many good games there are to bring to people that you can start to bring them into the hobby. My son-in-law wasn't a big gamer, and I brought out this game called Las Vegas, which was a dice rolling game. I would have put it on the list, but it's not readily available. But a great one of those games, and now he loves playing games with us, and so we've brought him into the hobby. And that's one of the great things, Christmas time. You have time with family where you can carve out some little bit of time where you can play a game that only takes 15, 20 minutes, like Codenames. Get people interacted so they don't think we're just out there doing these four-hour war games, you know?
Sure.
Or the Cocoa King, where you've got the monkey and you're flipping coconuts into cups.
Let me ask you just one more quick thing. This is off the notes, but if you're getting a gift for a gamer, just each of you give me one game that you would want to give somebody for a gamer because you think it's such a great game.
Ooh, complicated question. That depends on the gamer.
Yeah, it is.
Are they a minis gamer or are they Euro gamer?
Yeah, it's you've got someone out there that's a gamer. Rapid fire.
I'd give him a voucher.
That's hard. There's a lot to that question. I think I would give a gamer. What about, this is a good one. This is one that, again, that's in my top 10 that I think is really excellent. What about Viticulture from Stonemaier? I think that that's something that most gamers enjoy. Awesome components. And just a massive amount of replayability in that game. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you just made the Grinch's heart go three sizes larger, Brandon.
Yes, I like it. I like it. Yeah. But now you guys have to answer the same question instead of copping out on your own show.
Okay, yeah, I'll answer. I will buy them a very exquisite set.
He's looking at a stack of 20 games trying to decide which one of these he should, you know.
No, it's not a game. It's actually an accessory. I would buy them an insert for one of their games or a big set of coins that they can chop and change a game out of, you know, some dwarven coins or whatever. I would get them something like that. Every time they're fiddling with their coins, they'd be thinking of me.
Yeah, that's a great idea. There's so many of these wonderful accessory companies out there doing this. And I'm just going to throw out one of the games that I think would be great for a good chunk. I love this game, but it's Mare Nostrum from Academy Games. Love this game. It has area control. It has resource management. It has a lot of different trading going on. I think it's a great game, and a lot of people would really enjoy the production value of it because it's such a high-quality game. It's not horribly expensive, but it's a quality gift. So that's just a thought I had.
Yeah, because the only thing is we buy a game for a gamer is it going to go on their shelf of shame, or is it going to be a game that they play once and think, my God, why did they buy me this? Beep!
Yeah, obviously, you're buying a gift for someone. You probably know their taste a little bit better.
So
that's kind of a random question. But hey, this has been a blast. Brandon, thanks so much for being on the Berkey and Badger Board Game Battle Show.
Yeah, hey, I've had a blast. Yeah, I'm going to have breakfast now. Thank you, Kevin, for inviting me on. And I got to tell you there, Badger, that I've given you a hard time, but thank you for enduring the pain that is. I mean, this is just how we work. It's all in good fun, though.
Yeah, I know. I love pain.
Okay. Can I quote you on that?
Yeah, I've been waiting to go to the toilet for the past hour, and okay. I'm in pain.
Great. We better wrap it.
Let's go for another 20 minutes. And
wrap it up before I have to use my cup.
Brandon, tell us just a little bit about where people can get a hold of you, your show, sure. That type of thing.
Yeah. So, I mean, in my day job, my real world, I'm a web developer. Everything can be found on our website at brawlingbrothers.com. You can get to our guild by going to brawlingbrothers.com/guild and shoot me an email if you have questions or want to get a hold of us. Or we're on Twitter at Brawling Bros, on Instagram, Facebook. We're everywhere, man. We do it. We try to throw a wide net. So if you want to find us, you can. Brawling Brothers.
You're not there. You're not under my
own. Thank goodness that I'm not there.
Yeah. That's because you didn't wax, Barry.
That's right. We need a drum kick. Come on. Thank you.
No, you guys are really active on there. And I would highly recommend, if you haven't listened to the Brawling Brothers, great show, really well produced. Josh is a hoot as well. You guys have such fantastic chemistry and play off of one another so well. Plus provide gamers great information and a lot of entertainment value. And so I'd highly recommend there, go and check that out. And Barry, you want to send us off and let us know about where they can find us?
Yeah, in bed in about a couple of hours' time. Or
No.
I'm totally thrown now. Where can they find us? They can find us on boardgametheatre.com or boardgameseverybodyshoot.com, because that's his page and my page, and we also do a Berkey and Badger page on there. You can find us on Twitter, Stitcher, blah 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 blah, and every other
iTunes page. Don't forget iTunes. Send us a review.
Yeah, iTunes, send us an iTunes. We come on iCandy as well with beefcakes. and the
Board Game Geek Guild number 2248. Join us on the Board Game Geek Guild 2248.
Yeah, and then I'll set up a poll. You can rate all our guest stars in order of the ones that you prefer. I won't leave any hint about where we should put Brandon. But
right up at the top, folks. Come on, this has been so good.
But yeah, go along there. You'll find out when all our shows are if you subscribe to our guild, and because I post them a couple of days in advance. So if you want to join in on the live shows, thank you everyone for watching the live show. Kabuki Kid and Peter Shirley. Is it Peter Shirley?
Yeah, Peter Shirey.
Shirey, there you go.
And Maurice Moe's on there, and Jesse.
And Brandon Nail.
Branding Nail.
Yeah. Maurice. Yeah. So thank you very much for chatting.
LOL, Brandon.
Where we were chatting. Batman. Why does it say Batman? Oh, there he is. Hello. No.
Pete Shirey. No.
Everybody does it.
Shirey.
Yeah. This can be an outtake, I think.
Pete's awesome. Pete is absolutely awesome. We got to have Pete on the show sometime.
I'm going to have to go around Pete's house because I want to see his shark on his games room wall, because that's incredible. My daughter would just fall in love with that. And she'd tell you all the statistics about sharks.
Pete says now we get cookies. Isn't that special?
It's cookies, not biscuits. You don't have biscuits.
We were having this conversation off the air. It's not biscuits. We get cookie. Pete is giving us cookies.
Okay. Yes. Thanks, Pete. So all that remains.
Hey, we also want to give special thanks to Arcane Wonders for sponsoring the Berkey and Badger Show. Thanks so much to all the guys there. Check them out at arcanewonders.com. And with that, I think we are going to send you off with our ending song.
My speakers are gone asleep again. I have to wake them up. Wake up. There we go.
Thanks again, Brandon.
You guys, thanks for having me. Had a great time.
We had this time together. You know it's time to go.
You know, I should do one of those things like they do in the old 80s cop shows. We're laughing here. Ha, 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 ha. The music continues.
It won't be long till we have another show.
Google, sort yourself out.
Keep us in mind. Get online. Berkey and Badger will be back.
In no time.
I'm totally lost without the Google toolbox not working. Work! Google, if you're watching this, get rid of this invalid client error that I got. I want to do my toolbox.